You're watching Fox Sports, home to Major League Baseball, the National Football League, NASCAR, and the new home of the BCS. This is America's number one sports network.
Welcome to Winter Wonderland.
Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
A little bad blood here. A lot of bad blood. That happens to rookies a lot. That's just Bristol, baby. That's just Bristol.
You know I'll be bringing it in Bristol.
Fox Sports welcomes you to Drivers Gone Wild, the DirecTV 500 pre-race show. When we left you last, it was pushing, shoving, bumping, and bashing, and it'll continue today here in Martinsville, Virginia. Martinsville Speedway is NASCAR's oldest track. It's NASCAR's shortest track, and today it takes center stage. And we're glad you're with us from the Hollywood Hotel. Sunny, temperature in the high 70s. It's where America gathers every weekend for NASCAR with Darrell Waltrip, who's won here 11 times, Jeff Hammond, Chris Myers, and thanks for being with us. Well, is it 500 laps or 500 rounds? Which driver is
you
likely...
You mess up one more time and you'll find out.
...is mostly likely to run hot right away?
Hey, here's the deal. Today is the day that Kevin Harvick's got to put up or shut up.
Wow. All right.
I think he and Kurt Busch are going to find each other on the racetrack today, and we're going to find out who's the man.
Ooh, so what's the buzzword happens to be my friend, cool.
That means, no, hey, that'd be me.
Nah, you might be thinking you're cool, but hey, cool your brakes, don't lose your cool, be cool, and keep your cool.
And you guys are cool. For a number of drivers, they're happy to see Bristol in their rear-view mirror. Last week, NASCAR fined Jeff Gordon $10,000 and placed him on probation until August 30th after spin came to shove with Matt Kenseth. 5'9 Matt Kenseth and 5'8 Jeff Gordon.
By the end of the day, you may need a pair of these to settle your differences.
Jeff Gordon just got by Matt Kenseth. The 24 just went around.
17.
Got him.
Jeff Gordon out of his car, and he's not happy with Matt Kenseth.
And Jeff Gordon joining us from down on the track. He's won here 7 times, both races last year. Jeff, thanks for being with us. You've never been punished for your conduct by NASCAR in your career, so if you had it to do over again, would you still shove Matt Kenseth?
Yeah, because at the moment, you know, I was angry, and you know, you just go on your instincts, and you know, I not knowing what was going to happen afterwards. I mean, I reacted, you know, and I probably wouldn't have reacted like that, you know, had Matt not come over to me. So, you know, I don't like to do those things, but you know, at times when you got a great finish like that going, and you get knocked down the last lap, and you're at Bristol, tempers flare for everybody. I'm as human as anybody else.
Hey, Jeff, DW, I was just curious. You're on a pretty aggressive team. You got Chad and Jimmy over there. They're always pushing the envelope. You got Kyle out there pretty aggressive on the racetrack. Does that put any extra pressure on you as being a part of a team like that to step it up a notch?
Well, I don't look at that as necessarily aggressive. I mean, yeah, you're always trying to step it up. You have to step it up. And I feel like my team has stepped it up this year, and I plan on doing the same thing right along with them. You know, I'm excited about the way the cars are running and driving and the way the team's communicating, the pit stops. Everything's got me, you know, fired up. And, you know, I'm going to show it on the racetrack, and sometimes I might have to show it off the racetrack as well.
Well, Jeff, thinking about the race today, I mean, you've won here with 3 different crew chiefs. I mean, can you make it 4 today? I mean, and what makes it so special? What you do here, I mean, what do you do here as far as being able to win?
Well, I wish I could take all the credit, but the guys on this DuPont Monte Carlo SS team, they you know, got to get a lot of the credit as well. I mean, you obviously it takes, you know, the combination of a great car, you know, and it, to the liking of how I like to drive the car. There is a certain amount of, you know, skill when it comes to how you enter the corners, when you pick up the throttle, that allows you to make the car better and better, and the team to make the car better. But you know what? I look at these wins that we've had, and sometimes it's just been being, you know, having the track position at the right time. Sometimes it's staying out of trouble. This is definitely another survival short track, 500 laps. And I think if we can be in position towards the end, I think we've got a car capable of winning again today.
Hey, Jeff, DW, real quick. Remember what you told me? I was bragging on the car. Man, the car looks so good. The car is doing this. The car is doing that. And you looked at me as serious as you could be. You said, how do you know it's the car?
Well, sometimes it is the car, and I'm going to take some credit as, you know, at times as well. But, you know, today it's going to take the whole combination. I'm just glad that I'm playing a part in it.
All right, Jeff, thanks for your time. Good luck today, all right?
All right, thanks, guys.
Okay, Jeff Gordon starting fourth. Jimmy Johnson, his teammate, is on the pole. Here's what's around the turn. Matt Kenseth now has the points lead, but how will he do when he goes 10 laps with me? And DW and Jeff, tell us why the left foot is so important here at this track. Carl Edwards doesn't fight international terrorism, but he'll pretend to on TV. We caught the 99 behind the scenes of 24. And gas and go with Jeff and DW. Hot tempers and hot brakes. The DirecTV 500 straight ahead. We shill because we care.
Out on my race cars on the track, but if I have to, I will take it out on him.
There's trouble for Martin Truex Jr. A lot of smoke out of those tracker boats.
Matt Kenseth denied the win by Kurt Busch.
Welcome back to the DirecTV 500 pre-race show here in Martinsville, Virginia. Time for gas and go, or as we call it here, a little bump and run. They haven't seen the questions. We anticipate the answers. You're under a time frame. DW, 20 seconds. Was the punishment that NASCAR gave Jeff Gordon appropriate?
Well, they have to do the same thing for everybody. You can't make exceptions. So that means it was appropriate. Do I agree? No. Okay. I thought it was unnecessary. Did nothing wrong in my book.
I was getting ready to say, wait, where were you going with all this appropriate stuff there? It was wrong. He should have never got it. All he done was pushing.
No, I agree. But they have to treat it, you know, with that one guy gets fined for pushing a guy, you can't make an exception.
All right, good. Hey, easy now. Jeff, this is for you. Should Kurt Busch's win now shut Kevin Harvick up?
Yeah.
No.
No.
He's funny. It's not going to do that right there because of the fact I think these two have got something that goes way back, and it's not going to go away that simply. I'm just telling you right now. I'm like Daryl said earlier. These two guys, it's bound to happen. They're going to run into each other, and it's going to be ugly.
Look, you can't keep talking about a guy and talking like he does unless you go out there on the racetrack and do something with it.
Put up or shut up.
Kurt Roger in victory lane. All right, DW, 15 seconds. What should Martin Truex Jr. have done differently last week?
Well, he was out there. He was harassing Jeff Gordon, and he was doing it on purpose. And Tony Stewart was getting impatient. Tony's kind of the enforcer these days. I will give to you, but you better give to me. And I think he felt like Truex needed to get out of the way, and he didn't.
Hey, yep. He wound up, young bull, old bull. Guess what happened? Young bull lost.
38 for Truex. All right, Jeff, why doesn't Tony Stewart win earlier in the season? Just one win in the first 3 months, and obviously he dominates. He's led the most laps this year.
I think he starts off and kind of paces himself early on. He's got to race himself back into shape sometimes during the offseason. And I think figuring the cars out, getting that rhythm going. He's a rhythm racer, and I really believe he has to kind of get that kind of going on. My old buddy DW, a lot of times, he'd finish really strong at the end of the season when it really counted.
For a long time, I thought it was the Indy 500. I kind of thought that was a distraction in the back of his mind, but now I just think it's the way he is. He's right. A second-half player.
Time up. DW got a good one for you here.
What was
Jeff thinking with this wrestling thing last night? Did you catch some of this? We're not making this up.
I just want you to know, last night he was in his element. He was with his people.
Now, I want to, when he gets hit, now look, is this acting? It's all fixed, right?
No, you're crazy. If you think that's acting, I'll bring one of these guitars and hit you upside the head with it.
My grandmother used to think that men on the moon was fake and wrestling was real. So
I think it was real. What do you think?
It was real.
You know what? He should act on the moon. Wrestle on the moon. All right, let's check out the NASCAR Next.
I'll knock you to the moon.
Points to the
Alice. Out of here!
That was the first astronaut. Kenseth taking over the lead from Jimmy Johnson. Junior and Gordon are in there, but there are some guys, Jeff, who are
not. Oh, yeah, right now. Bobby LeBond, Sterling Marlin, and Michael Waltrip, they need to have good runs here today. They're still kind of like right on the edge.
All right, Hammond trying to act a little bit. Carl Edwards, you know, he jumped up in the standings. He got a little bit of acting. If you missed Carl's big move from 30th to 22nd, don't worry. You can still see him Monday on 24.
I'm here on the set at 24, and they gave me actual speaking lines in the show, so it's pretty cool. I'm getting to just kind of see how all this stuff gets done and get to meet some people.
He's got a really natural knack for it. Just in talking with him, I could tell that if I gave him a line, he'd be very comfortable.
And
background,
action.
Who are those people? That's Jim Hill from Homeland.
Jim Hill, Homeland Security. Show me your station.
Actually, I watched a couple takes. He was moving a little faster than our average extra.
Yeah, Carl's pretty famous for his backflips every time he wins a race. And when we knew he was coming, people were already trying to figure out where here in CTU he could actually do a backflip.
No, they were toying with me. They told me that Kiefer was going to, like, get in a fight with me and throw me, you know. I was like, man, I ain't losing no fight. They're like, look, he never loses.
My line of work is inherently less dangerous than his line.
This is a perfect example of how much my life has changed. I mean, it's a television show. I mean, I'm Carl Edwards. What am I doing here? You know, this is crazy.
Carl Edwards guest stars as Homeland Security expert Jim Hill on tomorrow's episode of 24 on Fox, 9 Eastern, 8 Central. We're counting you down to the DirecTV 500. The DirecTV pre-race show is sponsored by DirecTV. NASCAR driven by DirecTV. By Wendy's Original Spicy Chicken Sandwich, do what tastes right. By Sprint's, proud partner of the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series, and by Mobile Clean 5000, seriously tough oil.
Clint's been coming on strong.
Another of those great rookies, Clint Boyer.
He is a comer, guys.
He's had an impressive early season.
I tell you, the car looks really good.
Clint Boyer in the 07 car, 26-year-old Busch Series driver, a Nextel Cup rookie from Kansas. Jeff Hammond calls it the Rocky Mountain State.
Hey.
As a former dirt track driver, Boyer is kidding when he says he's unfamiliar with racing on asphalt, but the way he's driving, he's on a DirecTV path to victory lane.
Clint Boyer, take one. Take 38. Take 138.
Clint Boyer, take one.
Here we go. Hi, I'm Clint Boyer, driver of the number 07 DirecTV Chevrolet. I started racing motorcycles when I was 4 years old. When I was 16, I went to a local dirt track with my grandfather. 3 weeks later, I was trading two wheels for four. In 2003, I was working in a body shop. Anything from door dings to hail damage, a little bit of paint, whatever it took. Not so much here, but riding through here, it's pretty good. My favorite thing about DirecTV is that you can pause, rewind, pause, rewind, or fast forward. When I win a cup race, I can rewind it and watch it whenever I want. I'm a big Elvis fan for the simple fact that he had it all. Hey, he was the king. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I know it's one of your idols. All right.
What do you think? Maybe he was on The Sopranos one time. He goes to the show and he thinks he can act. He thinks he's got a job.
When you drove, how did you treat
Chris Myers' hair?
Rookies, yeah. We need more spray. How do they treat rookies today?
You know what? They got a yellow bumper. You know, they put that yellow tape on their back bumper for a reason. It's to draw attention to them. And one of the things as a rookie that you don't want to do is have people talking about you. You want to go through the first few races particularly low-keyed, stay out of trouble. There's your little yellow bumper. That's a warning.
All right.
It's a yellow flag. So you treat them a little differently than you do everybody else.
All right. Matt Kenseth, former Rookie of the Year. He was on the wrong side of a shove last week. Bristol, one of three races that he's led with 10 laps to go this year, but he's only won one. Still, that was good enough for me to go 10 laps with the former champ.
The greatest regret so far in racing that you have, is there one?
Oh, man, I got a list of them. I mean, whenever you do something dumb, you know, you definitely regret things. But probably a couple years ago when Kevin Harvick and I were going at it, I did some pretty dumb stuff there.
When you go on the internet, what do you usually, what's the first website you hit?
MattKenseth.com.
And what's the first car you owned or bought?
My very first car was actually, I think it was an 82 Honda Accord. It was an old car of my sister's. It was all beat up, and I had to work on it for 2 months before I got it to run.
Scale of 1 to 10, you give me a number. There's an unfair advantage to having a five-car race team.
Well, I'd say that's a one. I think that's untrue. I think if everybody had single car teams, I think it would be an advantage.
All right, Matt Kenseth is a risk taker.
You know, I'd say that's probably about a three or a four.
It's a bad thing if Brett Favre retires.
That's probably an eight or a nine. You know, I think that he's always really, really fun to watch.
If there is no Brett Favre, the Packers make the playoffs.
Well, they had Brett Favre this year, and they were, what were they, 4-12 or something? So I'll be cheering for him just as loud whether they win one game or they win them all.
Wisconsin guy. Hey, his crew, they had problems in the final session of practice. Did they get everything straightened out?
Got everything straightened out. He's really lucky because they broke a brake bracket on the right front, wheel locked up. They were able to go out and effect repairs. And like Robbie Reiser, crew chief, told me, he said, if we hadn't had that last practice, we'd have been in trouble today at the start of the race.
Very fortunate. I mean, that would have knocked him out of the race. It'd taken hours to repair, laps to repair, and so they were fortunate.
All right, who do you like today in this race?
Well, I truly believe it's Jeff Gordon and Tony Stewart's race to win, but also I believe that Kurt Busch, and I'm serious when I tell you Harvick, I believe they're going to have a go of it. I think they're going to be in the mix as well.
Well, I think as a rookie, first-timer as far as working with Roush out there, I would not discount, and that's Jamie McMurray. I think he's got an opportunity of doing something right there. And you were talking also, we take a look at him riding around with Tony, but you mentioned Casey Kane too.
No, I think Casey Kane's been running so well, I think he's also going to get a good finish. I don't know if he can win or not.
We thank DW for being with us. He'll head upstairs to call the race with the gang. The pole sitter ready to roll. Jeff Hammond and I will stay right here at the Hollywood Hotel. Thanks for being with us on the DirecTV 500 pre-race show from the southwest corner of Virginia in Martinsville. Welcome back to the DirecTV pre-race show on Fox NASCAR, driven by DirecTV, the sixth race of 36 scheduled races. Short track racing in Martinsville, Virginia. Before you hear gentlemen start your engines, you'll probably hear gentlemen cool your tempers. Let's head down trackside for opening ceremonies.
Anthem and the singing of God Bless America. Today's colors presented by the 29th Band Unit, Virginia National Guard. Today's invocation given by Reverend Eddie Honeycutt, Director of Missions, Henry County Baptist Association.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this beautiful day, for the spirit of competition. We pray today for safety, for drivers, crews, for spectators. Deliver them all safe back home. We thank you today for those military personnel that protect our freedoms around the world. God bless our troops. God bless this event. And God bless the USA. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
And now, singing God Bless America, please welcome Big Machine Records recording star, Danielle Peck.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans wide with foam. God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, my home sweet home.
And now for today's national anthem, number one recording artist, host of CD USA, it's Becky Bailey.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bomb that our flag, it was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave. God bless America. Thank you so much.
Martinsville, 170 miles east of Bristol, but the drivers and their crews will be side by side around this track today. Gordon and Kenseth, Kurt Busch and Kevin Harvick, Kyle Busch and Tony Stewart, just some of the matchups you'll see here, NASCAR on Fox.
Hey, this is Jeff Burton of the Singular 31 Chevy. Stay tuned for details on how to play the Singular Virtual Crew Chief during today's race. Watch for your chance to win my payday at the race in Daytona Beach on July 1st.
Welcome to the DirecTV 500 on Fox, sponsored by DirecTV, NASCAR, driven by DirecTV. For more than 150 years, steam trains and diesels have dragged coal to the sea through this peaceful valley, but for the last 60 years, the rumble and the roar that folks walk in a mile or more from where they park out on the highway to see stock cars go around this little half-mile paperclip-shaped oval that's situated right at the end of this neighborhood street. According to Tom Higgins' story, in 1947, H. Clay Earls crawled through a briar patch to find this little hollow and thought it would be a great setting for a natural oval speedway. And look at what it's become. Budweiser, official beer of NASCAR, is the proud sponsor of the Budweiser Pole Award, given to the fastest qualifier at each NASCAR Nextel Cup Series race. Budweiser congratulates Jimmy Johnson, the latest Budweiser shootout eligible driver. Here are the other 2006 Bud Pole winners. We'll have a look at the starting lineup for today's race. There's Tony Raines getting his first start in the DLP Chevrolet. Welcome to the short track that thinks it's a super speedway. Mike Joy with Larry McReynolds and Darrell Waltrip at the smallest track on the circuit, but it's certainly an action track. And Larry, a lot has been written this week about Martinsville just being another 500 laps of Bristol, but with less banking.
Yeah, but I think what happened in Bristol will stay at Bristol. Now, I agree with what DW said in the pre-race. I think this Kurt Busch, Kevin Harvick story, we've only scratched the surface. But it is a short track. It's almost 80 degrees. A lot of these drivers are already hot and aggravated. Trust me, we will have new groups that are mad at each other, maybe even after the race on pit road.
The cheers were loud in driver introductions, but the boos were too.
Yeah, well, you know how fans are. But let me tell you, don't underestimate the heat today. It's going to be 80 degrees. This track will get hot. It'll get slick. That's added brake heat, a lot of added heat in the car itself. Plus, it's a little bit harder tire than they've had here before. Cars are going to slip around a little bit. Aggravation, keyword of the day.
This is the first really beautiful day for racing we've had this Nextel Cup season, and we're about to get it started.
And now, race fans, for the most famous words in motorsports, the president of DirecTV Sales and Service, Mr. John Cerani.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
Getting set to go racing on an 80-degree plus day in South Central Virginia. And before we go racing on this flat, short racetrack, Darrell and Jeff had a chance to check things out in their Richard Petty driving experience car in the AutoZone driver zone.
All you hear at Martinsville is we talk about the brakes. First of all, if you look at my foot, I got my left foot up on the brake pedal. Now, that's the way every driver here this weekend will drive, left foot on the brake pedal. But the problem is, I'm riding, I get to racing, and
I'm riding with pressure on the brakes. I got my foot leaning on the pedal, even though the crew chief might say, what, Jeff?
Hey, keep your feet off the brakes. You got to save the brakes. Stay off the brakes.
I'm not touching the brakes. I just got my foot laying up there. But I am, and I don't realize it. So one thing that we've done in the past, Jeff, show them the light.
One thing we'll do is possibly put this light up on the dash so he can tell how much pressure the light will come on to say, hey, you got pressure on the cylinder, you got to get your foot off of it. And if that's not good enough, if he wants to have that foot up there, we'll also add a brake spring, a real heavy brake spring, to where he can let that foot lay on the brake panel, but not really have an effect to the brakes.
Not creating any extra heat, because heat does what, Jeff?
Makes the brakes get hot, hurts the tires, and eventually puts you behind the wall. You've got to have brakes for 500 laps here at Martinsville if you expect to win.
What are you doing in there anyway?
Well, hey, you taught me about brakes, but I want you to drive this thing today like you got an egg underneath the throttle. I want you to be smooth, man. I don't want you to break this thing. I want you to save my brakes and save my engine and win me a race.
Because if you don't, you're going to have egg on your face.
Jeff, that wasn't part of that omelet you had for breakfast this morning, was it, I hope?
It definitely wasn't, Mike, but at the same time, I think people can get the understanding what we're trying to make the message clear, because if you don't stay off the brakes, if you're not smooth with the throttle, you cannot win here at Martinsville. And my old buddy DW, he got it done 11 times, so he knows what he's doing.
Now, if you make it through all of that on the racetrack, then you have to encounter this pit road, similar to Bristol, but different. Jeannie Zelasco.
Absolutely. Welcome to my world, the pits in and around Turn 3. It is also the home for four of the six rookies in today's starting lineup. Guys who have really never seen this racetrack, like the 07 of Clint Boyer and the DirecTV Chevy. And thanks to TV, that's the closest he has been to Martinsville. That is, of course, unless you count computer games. But his crew chief, Gil Martin, says, you know, he can barely survive 10 laps on the computer. So what's a rookie to do? Well, he ran the truck race last night, finished seventh, but more importantly, he told me he got confidence. Did he get comfortable? He said, no way. Matt?
Jeannie, of the drivers who made changes at the end of the 2005 season, Kurt Busch was the first to go to victory lane in 2006. Now, a guy who also made a change and actually took over Kurt's old ride was Jimmy McMurray. Now, he would love to go to victory lane here at Martinsville. A little bit of a changeup this week. Instead of trying to run what his teammates have run as far as chassis setup, he and Jimmy Finney started to go down their own path, and it paid off in qualifying. Now, he qualified second. Now, what that also does, besides having a great starting spot on the racetrack, means he also gets to have a great spot here on pit road. He chose pit stall number 11, which is the second best pit, and I'll tell you why. Besides Jimmy Johnson down at the front of the grid, now Jamie can come into his pit box, and he has an open stall in front. Now, the pit boxes are 28 feet long. Now, the opening is a little bit shorter than normal. It's 14 feet, so what Jimmy will do, he will stop a little shorter in his box, which will help his exit even more. Jamie told me that the car was great in final practice, about a scale of an 8 on a scale of 1 to 10 going into today's race. He's very pumped up. Now to the editor of Speedway Illustrated, Dr. Nick Mergren.
Well, I'm going to be working the pits in turns 1 and 2. This is Jimmy Johnson's pit. He won the pole, and as a result, they get to pick their pit first. So they picked the best one of the whole bunch. Look at this. Nobody can block Jimmy Johnson in. When they're done pitting, boom, they're right back out on the racetrack. Today, Johnson's got a very fast car. He has won here before in this very same car. The crew, experienced, quick, knowledgeable. Nothing ruffles those guys. Moments ago, his crew chief, Chad Knaus, told me if this team executes today, they will win the race. Mike Joy?
Thanks, Dick, and you folks enjoy your first sunny, warm day of the season down there.
First time we've seen the sun since Fontana, California, I think.
That's right. Well, issue there on Kyle Busch. They were adjusting a mirror for him, a side view mirror.
More than likely got hit. Somebody working on the car this morning got hit and knocked it out.
How short is this track? They had to stop the field on the backstretch because all the cars in the starting field were not off pit road yet.
There it is, and you see why we call it a paperclip. Two drag strips connected by two U-turns. That's Martinsville.
Those straightaways are 800 feet long. You can get a lot of speed up on the straightaway here, probably 125, 30 mile an hour.
Larry, how about our FedEx racetracks today?
Well, a lot of it's been addressed in our pre-race show. You see here, length is 500 laps, 263 miles. That pit road speed, 30 miles per hour. Pit window for fuel, 140 to 150 laps. But based on the number of cautions we'll probably have, don't know if that's going to be an issue. Now the FedEx racetrack keys. Take care of your brakes. Jeff Hammond, DW, they've been talking about that during the entire pre-race show. Patience, not just for one lap, but for 500 laps, guys. You can't let those patience get away from you at the end of this thing and blow a good finish. And take care of your driver. We'd already talked about it. 80 degrees outside, that means 130 degrees inside that race car.
Got to keep the mule refreshed.
Take care of your announcer, too.
That's right.
I love this place. Darrell, when did you first come here?
I came here in 1973.
You and me both.
Yeah,
I fell in love with it.
It's always been a beautiful facility. The azaleas I used to have around here, the ducks, the pond. It was like no other. It was like a little Daytona then.
It's a nice family racetrack. Always has been.
You see right there, almost to 80 degrees, but we have two different surfaces here. The corners are concrete. 100 degrees is the track temperature there. Asphalt on the straightaway is 115. The concrete's much cooler. I like the concrete surface. It's more predictable. It doesn't change as much with the outside temperature.
It doesn't change temperature-wise, Larry, but it gets those little knots built up in the corner, the rubber knots. It's like little speed bumps. It'll chatter your car right loose if you're not set up right.
They've run 114 NASCAR Nextel Cup type races on this track since 1949. How many of them do you think went caution-free?
Would it be a goose egg?
I can't think of any.
None. You're right.
I'm not a historian of back in 1947. That was the year I was born,
we both just use common sense on
right,
that.
Yeah. I think the least was four laps. They had four laps of caution maybe back in 61.
You know, I could only help but watch Jamie McMurray's crew start preparing the tires. The crews never stop working here. The minute the cars drive off pit road to the checkered flag, they're always working with the tires, with air pressure. You see them right here adjusting the air pressure, probably on one of the next set of tires to go on.
Really, really close together, too.
The first race on this speedway with pavement was 1955. Speedy Thompson won it. The place was packed. 12,000 people. Today, well, there'll be, 80, 90,000 people
at
packed
least
in here, and space for more seats to be added on the backstretch.
And a lot of people watching us by virtue of DirecTV.
And we're getting ready to go racing. And I like to go racing. I can't wait to go racing.
Well, let's go.
Well, DW, it's a short track. I know it's hot. I know you're aggravated at me already. But you know what you better do? Reach up there and pull those belts tight one more time. Let's get this party started.
Boogity, boogity, boogity. Let's go racing, boys.
What Sterling Marlin in that 14 car was trying to make some move on the outside, and he got real loose off turn four. Now he's trapped up there.
Well, I've seen that in the past here where everybody tries to get to
turn one. Big crash. Well, that didn't take long, did it?
Caution is out. That's our DirecTV car with Clint Bowyer, Robbie Gordon in the seven.
There you go. Come on. There you go.
All of them get going, so they all will stay on the lead lap.
But you know what, Larry? You can spin out here. You can get involved in a lot of accidents during the day, and you can keep right on racing. You're not going as fast as we were at Bristol, so you don't hit the wall as hard. You don't tear the car up like you did at Bristol.
About 4.5 seconds slower lap here. Look at the trouble on Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s right front.
And the problem with that is, look, what do you see in there?
The brakes,
the fans, and all that stuff. And you can't race here without that now.
This looks like part of a chain reaction. There you see one of the brake cooling hoses hanging out of the right front of Robbie Gordon's car.
Oh, yeah.
I think they'll come in here crashing. The 19 gets boxed up. The 41 hits the brakes, and there's nowhere to go.
Nope. Chain reaction. Looked like Chad Blunt possibly in the 34 car got into the back of Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8.
From Clint Bowyer.
Front of you, slow it down, slow it down. Whoa, whoa, stop right there. Don't go forward.
Right in the back of Travis Quaffle.
Pretty hard lick on that car.
All right, stay working out.
Kyle Petty. Piling into the Schwann's car with its Victory Junction cam. Robbie Gordon, we mentioned, involved. Dale Earnhardt Jr. We're under the first caution of the day with just two laps complete in the DirecTV 500. Two laps in and a multi-car crash, at least six cars involved. There's one of them. And Dale Earnhardt Jr. left his pit quickly to try to stay on the lead lap, but he'll be back to repair all that. Robbie Gordon with similar damage. Also Kyle Petty. And it's a little early, but probably a good time with what we expect today for our State Farm Safety Report.
Today here at Martinsville, the one thing you want to do is keep your brakes cool and make sure you keep your tires cool along with that. And what you won't see here, folks, underneath the front of this Ford Cutaway car, but you can see here, is the elaborate ducking that keeps these brakes cool and helps protect all this stuff. The carbon fiber duct is up in the nose that the air comes in, feeds up through these three hoses into this elaborate carbon fiber ducking system that cools these rotors and protects the tires as well as the brakes. Rotors get in excess of 1,300 degrees. You want to keep those temperatures down to maintain brakes on the car at all times, as well as to protect those tires. That means the bead on the tire. If you get too hot, you'll melt the bead and lose a tire. You don't want that to happen here at Martinsville, so keeping the brakes cool and keeping your tires protected are very important today.
And there you see some more of that brake ducting. This is on Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car, and that's going to have to come off there. Larry, wasn't long ago those ducts were fabricated from aluminum, and now we're in the space age.
Much lighter in the area that you want lightweight. But the problem with these guys like Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car is he's coming back on the pit road now. About the time he stops in his pit box, the pace car is coming down the front stretch, so there's very little to no time to do any repairs. Kyle Petty's been on pit road several times in this 45 car.
And Dick Bergeron could update us on Kyle.
Well, he had made multiple pit stops here, Mike, and the problem, the principal problem that they're working with is that the right front pin that hinges the hood broke completely off. So one of the mechanics drilled a hole in the hood, and then they put a rubber strap from that down to the lower portion of the right front corner of the bodywork. The whole point, try to keep the hood on the car. You're probably going to be back in again for still some more work. Ryan Newman has run over debris. They're worried about a flat tire. 7 car also with trouble.
Yeah, a lot of smoke out the right header pipe, right exhaust pipe. You see what's left of it there on Robbie Gordon's car. Dale Earnhardt Jr. too fast exiting the pit. He took the penalty to try to stay on the lead lap. But now the pace car is in as they pick up debris from Earnhardt's brake ducting system along pit road. We're set for a restart.
But they're coming to the green. Jimmy Johnson at the start-finish line. Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car is in the middle of 1 and 2. He's 3/4 of a lap down right there on that restart. I think that restart snuck up on him, DW, it looked like. I mean, you can see it right there. Already the back of the field is coming off turn 4. The leader, Jimmy Johnson, in the 48s in the middle of 3 and 4. That's the box you get painted in here if you're at the back of the field or have a problem early.
Darrell, all the more reason why you have to save your stuff, because here you don't have time to fix it and stay on the lead lap.
No, and the start is the most critical part, because the cars are so tightly packed that if you have an accident or anything happens in front of you, like you get down here in turn 1, more likely the chain reaction, you're going to get into it.
2 cars went to the garage as a result of all that, Chad Chaffin and Robbie Gordon.
And I made a mistake a while ago. It was Chad Chaffin, not Chad Blunt, that got into the back of Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Jeff Gordon makes a move on Sterling Marlin, who again up there in the high groove. And here comes Elliott Sadler with Gordon in the 38.
And I'll tell you what, Kurt Busch in that 2 car, Darrell, we watched him in practice yesterday. He looked awfully good, especially on the long run, the winner from Bristol.
I think there's 3 race cars out there right now that are really good. The 2, the 48, and the 20. Those are the 3 best cars.
The one that's getting a little impatient is the 26, Jamie McMurray. Just made a big dive into turn 3. And a spin is the 32, Quapel, who was involved in the first caution. And now he'll go a lap down.
Another thing I'm seeing is exactly what I expected. A bunch of ill-handling race cars. The track is hotter, slicker. A lot of guys were fighting with the track yesterday afternoon and the final practice, and right now I see them all having a little bit of a handling problem.
And remember, since their final practice, there's been a 250-lap truck race on this racetrack.
I think you're just going to see Quapel go down here and lose it. Ooh.
It's a safer barrier, but DW, he was at the back of the field. He was one of those cars where he could already look in the rearview mirror and already see the leaders coming.
Second caution of the day, just 14 laps into the DirecTV 500. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by DirecTV. NASCAR, driven by DirecTV. By Toyota, choose any direction as long as it's forward. Toyota, moving forward. By Sprint, proud partner of the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series. And by Allstate, official insurance sponsor of NASCAR. Nice to have you with us here in Martinsville. Jimmy Johnson, the pole sitter, leading 17 laps in. We've got a couple of cautions. It's time for the singular virtual crew chief question. Would you use the bump and run to win today's race? Let us know yes or no. To answer, text the word crew to 191 on your singular wireless phone or log on to foxsports.com/singular. You'll also be entered to win Jeff Burton's payday at the July race in Daytona. Jeff, how about it? I mean, we saw that last week.
Yes.
Matt
yes again.
Okay, you do it. Matt Ketchum didn't like it. Kurt Busch said, hey, it's a part of racing, especially on short tracks.
Beating and banging, baby. Beating and banging.
Tony Raines of Hall of Fame Racing, the 41-year-old from Indiana, currently running 12th in the, making his first start in this race.
Yeah, getting a chance to take a look at him sitting there behind the wheel. And I'm sure Tony's excited about being back in the car. It's been a long time since he's been able to drive so far this year. But I know he was excited. The team was excited. Great qualifying effort by them. So it'll be interesting to see what kind of performance he can put on today.
All right, let's rejoin the guys upstairs.
Tony Raines running in 12th, his best finish ever, 6th. Little remedial repair on Martin Truex's number one, pushing down the front valance on his car. And Travis Quapple's gone behind the wall.
You get you a DLP TV, you hook it to a DirecTV dish, and tune in NASCAR on Fox. What have you got? You got yourself a fun afternoon.
I would say. But you said it better. That's good. All right, we've completed 19 laps. Jimmy Johnson has led them all from the pole. Jamie McMurray nipping at his heels. Ryan Newman, Tony Stewart, Casey Kane, horsepower. You want horsepower?
I hear something, Mike.
Yeah, there it goes along. I hear a train a-coming.
It's rolling around the bend.
Norfolk Southern hauling empties back from Tidewater.
Need to also mention Robbie Gordon. We mentioned he was having some problems a while ago. Looked like engine to 7. He's in the garage. And remember, he's sitting 20th in the points right now. Good start to this season, but things would have missed early here.
Lights are out on the safety car. 40 cars on the lead lap. Quapple, Robbie Gordon, and Chaffin in the garage. Already a number of fenders and valances and bumper covers missing or askew.
No tempers flaring yet, though.
No.
I think everybody's pretty calm right now. You got the most amount of patience right now you're going to have all day.
DW, we've ran 21 laps, and I think 14 of them have been under caution.
Roger that. I'm cool.
Green flag. McMurray for the lead.
You can just tell McMurray in the 26 car, he's trying hard to get those 5 points for leading the lap.
Yeah, he's looked inside of Jimmy Johnson on every restart so far, but Jimmy seems to get it going. It's a couple of laps and he kind of pulls away a little bit.
Kyle Busch inside of Dave Blaney, coming out of 4, makes the pass.
It's going to take some laps to get it where your car can get some bite, can grip the racetrack in that second group.
Well, in practice, it takes 8 to 10 laps to get the heat in the tires, and you'll run your fastest lap on your 8th or 10th lap, unlike a lot of places we go, where it's on the 1st or 2nd.
Stewart looking on Newman. Ryan gave him room. Here comes Tony.
And that's what happens. You start the pass coming off the corner. You complete the pass going in the corner.
Newman trying to hold off Casey Kane. Quite. Now watch the 5 couple laps ago. ducking in on Bobby Labonte, and Dave Blaney gave him room.
But that was the look of an experienced driver in Bobby Labonte, the 43 car. Give and take early in the race. And there was a lot of giving by him right there.
Ryan Newman's in trouble, Darrell. He can't get back to the inside.
Well, we saw that with Sterling Marlin, and he's way back here, in about 10th place. So it affected him the same way. There's no grip out there.
Robbie Gordon out of the race with Genie.
Yeah, so much respect for Robbie Gordon. What he's trying to do is a full-time owner, driver. Engine's supposed to be not a problem coming into 2006, but that's what we're seeing out here today.
Yeah, you know, we've had some good runs this year so far with number 7 Chevrolet, and what a disappointment to be the first car out here at Martinsville. Had high hopes for the weekend. Been up in the top 20 every practice yesterday. Thought that we had a good shot at it, but we just don't know really exactly what the problem is. Guys are taking a look at it, but I'm pretty sure we're done.
This dedication, guys, you know, he may be done for the day, but this is just the beginning of this long season for him.
Thanks, Genie. New leader, McMurray, and pressure from Stewart kicked Jimmy Johnson up to the high side, and now he's going to get freight train.
Yeah, I was just getting ready to say that the 48 was holding everybody up, and about that time, McMurray got under him over there off the 2. And I think he's going to fall back considerably now.
And Darrell, where he started hurting Jimmy Johnson in the 48, the car was just stopping in the middle of the corner. The car wasn't rolling through the middle of the corner like it should.
Looks a little snug right in the middle of the corner.
McMurray has a second place finish here and three other top tens in his last 5 Martinsville starts.
You know, McMurray had some interesting comments this week after 5 races of 2006. He said, I think we have finally figured out I just can't run the setup of my teammates. We've tried it and tried it. Looks like to me they're on track with something here.
Forces the issue just a little bit there.
Well, he's been better getting down in the corner. He's kept looking to the inside. I think Johnson must have given him a little bit of room that time.
Tony Stewart in that 20, he was going to fill that hole before Jimmy Johnson had a chance to get down.
Matt Yoakum's in the leader's pit.
With the early cautions, Mike, now Jimmy McMurray was telling Jimmy Fitting he felt like the car was loose in and too tied up, and he wanted to wait for the pressures to build up. If they don't build up to his liking, talking about a right rear air pressure change. But right now, the car running very well out front in his mirror. The guy who's led 530 of the last 1,000 laps here at Martinsville, and that's Big Orange Tony Stewart, who's starting to get closer and closer to that bumper, the 26.
Well, the NASCAR has got a minimum right side, right front tire pressure here. It's 23 pounds, 22 pounds in the right rear, and 10 pounds is in the left side tires. Those are low pressures, but you can get down to, 18 or 19 pounds if they would let you.
But what
right
we need
sides.
To explain, Darrell, is if the car performs better, as Tony Stewart, the 20 almost gets by Jimmy McMurray in the 26. He's going to take the lead down the backstretch. So Stewart looks like he's going to lead this lap. But if the car runs better once the pressure's built up, why did they not just start him up there? You heard Jeff Hammond talk about brake heat. All this heat makes the air pressure grow, and if it just keeps growing, the car gets like a basketball with the air pressure. So you have to start it down low, but not to the point it hurts the car early in the run.
Since low gear here, you have a tendency to spin the rear tires, so you're always trying to get those rear tires as low as you can, knowing they're going to build up. If they build up so much, you lose traction.
Stewart and McMurray have taken off just a bit. Jimmy Johnson holding Casey Kane there in fourth. Jeff Gordon fifth. Ryan Newman sixth. Elliott Sadler seventh.
It's not unusual to be a little bit tight when you first start a run on low air pressure. Jimmy Johnson's car may have just been so tight he had to back off a little bit and let those tires build up before he could really go, because now he's holding his own.
Which means it was sliding the front wheels just ever so slightly in the middle of the corner.
Biggest mover right there, Kyle Busch. He has climbed from 17th to 10th, and that's no small order on a track this tight in just 37 laps. Genie.
Biggest mover, but he's also carrying some baggage, quite possibly. They think they've spotted some trash on his grill, so they've told him to keep an eye on those water temperatures.
And for the second week in a row, Genie and Mike, Kyle Busch had an altercation in final practice. This group had to repair some body damage yesterday afternoon.
Jeff Burton and Bobby Labonte duel.
It's amazing, Darrell, how many RPM this thing turns at the end of the straightaway and how low it
still
is
there.
In the middle of the corner.
Your door.
Yeah, and
still there.
The kind of RPM we turn here doesn't hurt the engine at all. It's just up and down. It's not sustained.
And you can see 57 miles per hour down in the middle of the corner, well over 100 at the end of the straightaway.
The Bush brothers. Kyle passes older brother Kurt for eighth place. Laps complete of 500 in the DirecTV 500. Tony Stewart, your leader.
Nothing's wrong with a little bump and run.
Zach Cipadelli helping out Dad today.
Crew chief in training.
You bet. How about that?
That'd be about the time Tony Stewart took the lead, I would say. Right now, that we're 49 laps into this race, he's starting to catch the back of the field, so he's having to start working lap traffic now. And that's when it starts bottlenecking up behind him. Second, third, fourth, and fifth start catching the leader.
Mike Garvey slows and is headed for pit road. Chad Chaffin has returned to the race after spending time in the garage as we cycle through 50 of 500 laps. Stanton Barrett has also taken his car to pit road. Stewart the leader. McMurray is 1 second behind. Jimmy Johnson, Casey Kane, Jeff Gordon, Elliott Sadler, Kyle Busch, Ryan Newman, and the two car, last week's winner, Kurt Busch. Now he's dropped back a few spots in the last 10 laps. We listened in to team communication.
How come the rear gear keeps popping? Like those springs are too loose or tight.
That's a ratchet in the rear end. It's what we call it. And they got springs in there. They lock the tire. They lock both rear tires up on the straightaway. They kind of ratchet in the middle of the corner, let the thing turn. I've had them do that. They'll pop, crack, raise a little bit of cane. Usually not a problem.
Speaking of cane, here's one, Casey. Taking it to Jimmy Johnson for third place.
On the outside, too. He got on the outside of him down in turn four, and he's just going to take it away down here in turn one and two.
That nine car is starting to really be impressive. Week in, I don't mean start to be. That nine car is impressive week in and week out. Everywhere they've been this year.
He finished second here a year ago. I talked to his crew chief, Kenny Francis, this morning. I think their goal here today, try to win the race, but if not, do what they did last week at Bristol. Good, solid finish. Remember, they are second in the points.
So Kane pulls away from our pole sitter, Jimmy Johnson. What about Johnson, Dick?
Well, the driver has said nothing to the crew, but the crew is saying a lot to Jimmy Johnson. And what they are trying to do is make sure that he is comfortable with where he is running. They're telling him he's running a good line. They're telling him that he's doing very well. Don't worry about anything. But I'll bet these radios are going to be filled with chatter when we get a caution flag. And Johnson tells the crew what they're going to need to do to fix that car.
Dale Jarrett with some left front body damage, going a lap down to race leader Tony Stewart. Also a lap back now, Dave Blaney, Clint Boyer, Stanton Barrett.
Did he get quite a bit of damage early?
He was involved in that crash down in turn one and two on lap two.
Hadn't had a great weekend. Spun out in practice yesterday. Got hit by the 11 car, Denny Hamlin.
And he's been to pit road under both cautions trying to make repairs to the UPS car.
There's Jamie McMurray moving past Clint Boyer, who is one lap down. McMurray is in second place. Matt.
He's about 2 seconds back of leader Tony Stewart. Now, Mike, he was telling Jimmy Finning on the radio that he's trying to let off the brakes earlier at his normal braking point than he would, because the brakes just feel different to him. He has a little bit of a weird feeling, so he's trying to conserve his brakes. Says it's a little bit loose and a little bit tight at this juncture in the race. He also was wondering if maybe it has a little bit to do with the fact that the Craftsman Truck Series raced yesterday, and maybe the track is feeling different to him because of that from the way it felt during happy hour.
Oh, man, I don't think there's any question about that. I mean, there's going to be rubber buildup in the turns here much quicker today than normal. And Roush has had a little bit of a history of having some brake issues. I remember Martin had some issues with brakes last year, and I think maybe even Kurt did somewhere. Kurt Busch.
22nd place battle here. Kevin Harvick has just driven past the 99 of Carl Edwards, and that opens the door for Jeremy Mayfield off turn four.
And Jeremy Mayfield in the 19, unlike his teammate Casey Kane in the 9, he's still looking for his first top 10 finish. And if this team don't get going, they're going to be on the brink of falling out of the top 35 in owner points if they're not careful.
Well, there's a car right in front of Tony right now that's in the same boat, Larry Michael. He's 34th in owner points, and he needs to pick it up a notch, too.
Riding with Michael Waltrip right here in the Napa Dodge.
We go to Texas next week, and we're very happy to be able to tell you that Steve Burns will be back with our NASCAR on Fox crew, recovering from a sinus infection. Behind his left eye, spent some sheet time in the hospital, but he's up and around and critiquing our broadcast today. And Steve, glad you'll be back with us. Also, Tommy Giannacchi, Brake Fielden, and Lynn Jeffers from our NASCAR on Fox staff under the weather. And a quick, is it happy birthday to our pit producer, Pam Miller's dad? Sure. No, it's not happy birthday. Recovering from surgery. Not quite the same thing.
Hey, Deb, you look at old Tony Raines there. That's a great shot. Got our telemetry down here. You can see how he has to just play with the throttle until he gets all the way up on the straightaway.
Now, normally we would run a steering box 16 to 1, maybe 20 to 1 some places. But here you run an 8 to 1 steering box.
Very quick.
Quick, like a go-kart, almost like an Indy car, because the turns are so tight. And you can see how much effort it takes to get a car through the corner here. A lot of rookies have come here, and they don't realize how much you've got to turn the steering wheel.
Tony's in the top 20, and Matt is in his pit.
Mike, 2 laps ago, his lap time was just a whisker off of leader Tony Stewart. And that's what he said. The car is just a whisker loose during that last caution. Now it's just gotten worse and worse. He's slowly fading from 12th all the way back to 17th at this point. Now, they're already talking about what adjustments they want to make. But what a great qualifying effort on Friday. They backed it up with a very solid performance in final practice. This young man, really, he's 41 years old, so not young, but as far as Nextel Cup experience, not a lot of experience coming up to the trucks, and Busch having a very great effort here in his debut with this 96 team.
Now, I don't know how old is, but 41 is pretty young.
That's
to me.
That's young to us, yes.
Well, we were talking about Jamie McMurray a while ago with the 26 car. Casey Kane in the 9 had went by him for second. Now right here, he's going to lose third position to Jimmy Johnson in the 48. A little bit of help right there, but there's no question Jimmy Johnson was much faster than McMurray right there.
And hadn't McMurray given a little help to Jimmy's back bumper when Jamie was trying to pass him for the lead?
Oh, yeah.
Paybacks are Martinsville.
It is a short track.
I'm sorry, Pam. I knew I had one birthday to do today. Bill France Jr., April 4th.
Whoa, don't
Happy
get
birthday.
That wrong. We're gaining on it.
You're watching the DirecTV 500 on Fox.
Welcome back to Martinsville and the DirecTV 500. Tony Stewart, your leader, has led the most laps today. Time for a Visa race break from the Hollywood Hotel. 3 leaders, 2 lead changes, a couple of cautions, 1 car currently out of the race. Jimmy Johnson started on the pole, but right away, rookie Quint Boyer, this looks like a log jam here. 9 cars involved in this caution on the 07 DirecTV car. You can watch the accident, and then on Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s 8 car, that left him needing a nose job. Once they got to repairing things, Travis Wapen, who was one of those involved in that previous wreck, spins and loses in turn 1 as well, bringing out another caution safely into the safer barriers. Jamie McMurray, after Jimmy Johnson led the first 26-27 laps, weaving his way ahead of Jimmy, right behind him Tony Stewart, and then a few laps later on lap 34, there goes Tony shooting to the front. And our DirecTV race summary, hopefully you're getting the idea here. You see the specifics so far as we're on lap 82, and Tony Stewart, Jeff Hammond, has dominated this race leading laps. In fact, the last 2 Martinsville races, he's led 530 out of 1,000 possible laps, but hasn't won.
He hasn't won, and that's the key thing right now. He may be running too hard too soon, and for a lot of these guys, they may be kind of pacing themselves. Like Jimmy Johnson, he started on the pole. He's keeping this guy in sight, trying to save his brakes, save his car a little bit to try to go through there. But one of the guys that got involved in the wreck early on, Dale Earnhardt Jr., he's back at 22nd, but he's making his way up through there. He's putting pressure right now on Kevin Harvick in the 29, and he's looking pretty racy, Genie.
Yes, he is, Mr. Myers. He survived the rhinoplasty, and he says that the car is actually great. He was originally looking for forward bite, but he's real happy with the car right now. And as you brought up, Mr. Harvick, now it's his problem. He's looking for forward bite. Everybody's looking for bite, Chris.
Hi, Jeannie. Meanwhile, four wins in the state of Virginia, the most for any of Tony Stewart's victories. This has been a Visa race break. No matter what it takes, life takes Visa. Mike?
Thanks, Chris. 85 laps complete. Tony Stewart has been out front for 52 of them. Casey Kane sits half a second back. Jimmy Johnson, Jamie McMurray.
See, the thing on Junior's car, and Larry knows this, Jeff does, that right front being torn off right there, that's helping him. It's cooling that right front tire down.
The tire rev on the left front, however, is not helping.
Yeah, that's minor, but all that air blowing on that tire right there, keeping the brake cool, keeping the tire cool, and that's the one you worry about.
And I think that's the biggest thing, is keeping that tire cool, because that's the tire that builds so much air pressure, because that's where all the heat happens to be. But I'm going to tell you what, back to Tony Stewart, the 20-hour leader, he is picking them up and laying them down, putting some good race cars a lap down. He just put Mark Martin in the six car a lap down, and a few laps before that put Mark Martin's teammate, and Carl Edwards in the 99 car, a lap down.
But that guy right behind him in that big Dodge Ram on the hood is keeping pace with him. He ain't letting him get out of sight.
Casey Kane keeping him at bay.
A couple of changes in the top 10. Jeff Burton has moved up to 8th. He's come from 20th. And here is Greg Biffle moving past Ryan Newman. This is for 9th.
Jeff Gordon is in trouble down turn 2, 4. Got a right front down, I think. I think he's got a right front tire down.
Definitely looks like a tire down. Caution is out. That is a big break.
Keep it up, Bert. Keep it up, Bert. Take it easy there. Take it easy on the rim right now. Okay, start easing it down. Start easing it down. Got the 01 coming inside right there. Come on down.
Debris from Gordon's tire has brought out the caution at lap 89.
Yeah, right in the middle of the corner down there, Larry, the car just shot up the racetrack, so definitely cut a tire down.
And that was Jeff Gordon's spotter talking to him, trying to get him down to the bottom of the racetrack, telling him what he was seeing about this right front being down.
You see him right here coming down through the middle of the corner. Back here in the screen, you see him take off. He doesn't hit the wall. He gets it wowed up because it blew. It actually went down right in the center of the corner, right the slowest part, so he was able to keep it off the wall.
So far, he's still on the lead lap, but that may not last.
I don't know if he can. Yeah, I think he's going to be okay.
If they'll change just right side tires and he will speed leaving pit road, he should be able to stay on the lead lap, Jeannie, if he can do it.
All right, with a 5 of Kyle Busch. Don't waste any time. That was the order for this pit stop. Pull those fenders out because they were knocked in. He's going to get 4 tires. That's the plan, and that's what they're sending over the wall. Matt?
Leader Tony Stewart is in. Air pressure change. Needs more help with forward bite. I mean, he needs to work on the car's handling on exit, up off the corner. He's away. The 26 of Jamie McMurray. His car was loose and tight. It was loose on entry, tight in the center, and then loose on exit. Nick?
Jimmy Johnson, another driver who needs forward bite. He has already left the pit area right behind the 20 of Tony Stewart. The car tends to be a little bit loose in the center. Johnson has adjusted his line on the racetrack. That made the car much better for him.
There you see the race off pit road. Jimmy Johnson in the 48 gained a spot a lot because of his pit selection at final pit box before leaving pit road.
Stewart out first, Johnson and Kane. Very alert work by Tony Stewart's spotter as Jeff Gordon came shooting out of his pit with fresh tires.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by Budweiser, the official beer of NASCAR, and proud sponsors of Dale Earnhardt Jr. and the number 8 car.
We've just restarted at the half mile, Martinsville Speedway. Tony Stewart out front after pit stops. Caution flag was for tire debris from Jeff Gordon. Gordon pitted too soon, had a couple of other pit road violations. A concurrent rather than consecutive sentence put him to the tail end of the longest line.
Boy, DW, they were stacking up over there in turn 2, were they not?
Some pretty aggressive driving getting off into turn 1 that time.
And there's the log jam right there. Mark Martin trying to get back on the lead lap, as is Casey Mears.
Well, we got a battle for about 11 cars trying to become the first car a lap down to get that free pass like Jeff Green did on the last caution.
Jeff Burton's had a good car these first 100 laps. He's in eighth place. Now let's update the problem on Jeff Gordon's car that brought out the caution. Here's Matt.
Gordon runs back in 24th, Mike. Now he made one of his stops on pit road, so Steve Letarte could have his over-the-wall guys jack the car up and look underneath it just to make sure there's so many hoses in the front of the car for the bead blowers and other brake blowers, just to make sure that none of the hoses, maybe one of the hoses came undone and cut that tire. Under further review by Goodyear's engineers, they felt that he melted a bead on the tire. That's why he had that flat tire. And here at Martinsville, they don't run the inner liners, the tire in and tire, and that really could have caused an even bigger problem for Gordon. Luckily right now, he runs back in 24th, up to 23rd, trying to bounce back from this issue.
And remember, Jeff Hammond talked about that in his safety report, melting the bead of the tire. I mean, that's something you can do here easily with as much heat as generated.
And when a driver like Jeff Gordon, who is really, really easy on his car, really, really easy on his brakes, has a problem like that, that kind of bothers me. Might be an indication of other guys that are going to have problems, because Jeff is easy on his stuff.
He's battling Kevin Harvick for 22nd.
And what I meant by he should speed off pit road, he had already had a penalty by pitting too soon, tailing the longest line, speeding, leaving your pits under caution, tailing the longest line.
Reed Sorensen to the inside. This is for position. You're riding with Harvick.
Mike, looking at Reed Sorensen in the 41 car, remember, we're at race number 6. All of the rookies like Reed Sorensen, they had never seen Martinsville because the Busch cars, they've not been racing here. Denny Hamlin is the only guy that raced here in the fall. In fact, J.J. Yaley in the 18 car called his crew halfway up here Friday morning and said, "Where is this place? I can't find it."
Well, this year, the Busch Series will race at Martinsville.
Yeah, they will, won't they?
Yeah, we will in July the 22nd under the lights.
Time to pay off our singular virtual crew chief question. Would you use a bump and run to win today's race?
Pick me, I'll tell you.
Yeah, you and 88% of our viewers. Of course.
If it's on the last lap and you won't, you better think about it again.
Well, you're going to have your crew ready to hurt you if you don't do it.
There was an interesting thread on this whole bump and run thing following Bristol, and it came from, I believe, Matt Kenseth. And he says, "I apply the what would Mark Martin do test. If Mark Martin would do it, then I'd give it a try. But if Mark Martin wouldn't do it, I wouldn't do it." Interesting.
That's what I call passing the buck.
Speaking of Matt Kenseth, our points leader in the 17 car, remember, he started back in the 16th position. He's just being quiet back there, running his own pace, but right now he is up into the top.
Oh!
And around goes Biffle. Biffle was trying to get past Jeff Burton. And Kenseth was there.
I don't know if maybe Biffle will have to take a look at it. Looks like Biffle may have. I know that he and the 31 made contact, but I'm not sure if Biffle got out a little too before or...
Fourth caution flag of the day, and it's Greg Biffle coming off turn two.
These cars were all battling for position.
Car is really hurt. Now watch him come off here. The Biff gets a little loose off of there, and they make... His right front tire hits the 31's right left rear tire, and it causes him to spin out. So he gets loose right there. He's underneath him, and then they just made contact off that corner. Had that happened to me before. Kind of knocks the steering wheel right out of your hands if you're in the 16.
This has been a typical Greg Biffle 2006 right here.
Dick Bergren.
Yeah, Biffle has had just a terrible, terrible year so far. Just seems as if every racetrack something happens to him. He's just been on the radio and told the crew that we're done for the day, but his crew chief, Doug Richards, said bring it in. They want to take a look at the car, fix it if they can, send him out, make some laps. They need the points.
Well, the right rear is shoved way, way forward on the car now. It looks like they bent the rear end housing to me.
Biffle came in here 14th in points. Right now sits 16th. Make it 17th as he's on pit road. Four cautions in the first 110 laps today. The first one was lap two right there. The next one, same place, and one of the cars that was involved in the first one. Jeff Gordon came to a stop there at turn three, and now at the exit of turn two, that's where Greg Biffle goes around.
I'm concerned. We only have 19 numbers on there.
Only got four turns, though. That's good news.
Turn three is open.
Yeah, we got plenty of room over there.
Welcome back to the DirecTV 500 on Fox. 114 laps complete. We're going to send you to the volume control of that big surround sound system you have because we're getting ready for the restart. We're getting ready to crank it up. Because you asked for it. Crank it down.
You asked for it, we deliver.
Rookie Denny Hamlin got the free pass on that caution flag, so we're back to green with Tony Stewart leading Jimmy Johnson, Casey Kane, Elliott Sadler, Jamie McMurray, Kyle Busch, Jeff Burton, Matt Kenseth.
There's a lady down in Florida right now that is tickled to death with that little graphic.
Greg Biffle got a lot of damage and is off track right now, eight laps down. Dick Bergman.
Yeah, his best finish so far this year, Mike, had been in seventh place. They've got trouble on the right front corner. The ducting that goes to the brakes is all torn up. But the biggest problem is underneath the car. The rear housing is well out of line. They're going to have to replace the truck arms that locate the rear end in the automobile. That's going to have to square the rear end in the car. If it's off, if it's not square in the car, it'll be a handful to drive. My guess is this thing's beat up enough, it's going to be a handful to drive, no matter what.
And Biffle has now fallen to 20th in the Nextel Cup standings.
We need to update you on Jeff Gordon in the 24 car. Remember, he had that flat tire back on lap 89. He was one of about six cars that came to pit road on that last caution and changed tires, and now he has worked his way past Tony Raines back up to the 18th position. Remember, still on the lead lap.
Tough day for Carl Edwards. He may need some help from Kiefer Sutherland in the cast of 24. Watch the 99 here.
He's out of bounds. That white part is the best part to stay on. You get above that, you're in trouble. Get all that build up on your tires.
And Darrell, you know, we had Carl on our trackside show a couple of weeks ago, and we said, what do you need to improve on from 2005? He said, road courses and Martinsville. He came here and qualified pretty good, but they do not have their arms around this place today.
I just believe that the Roush cars in general, now Kenseth certainly looks pretty good, but in general, I think they try to run the same kind of chassis setups here, or geometry and all here, that they do on the mile and a half, where they're so dominant, and it just doesn't work here.
Need to mention Mike Garvey in the 51 car, back out on the racetrack, 73 laps down.
Jeff, Tony Stewart has opened up a pretty sizable lead for Martinsville now, 1.1 seconds.
And as usual right now, Mike, he's really making it look easy around this racetrack. But what I want to do is go back and talk about the Roush cars. Now, Darrell, you talk about what is going on, you know, with the 6 and the 99, for example. But I'd like to point out also the 26, Jamie McMurray, he's driving for Jimmy Finnick. And Jimmy Finnick has won here recently with Kurt Busch. And I think a lot of that has to do with maybe the coaching the crew chief is doing with these guys. and coming with a package that is very comfortable. I think Jimmy is a veteran of this racetrack, of many years working with Bobby Allison and other veteran drivers, and he understands the principle of getting the car to launch off the corner. And working with Jamie right now, I see this in the 26 car. The car looks solid. It needs a little bit of tuning, but he's really right where you want to be. Very running very smoothly. He gets ready to try to work under his teammate, Mark Martin. But the car is making solid runs. And if I know Jimmy, he's telling him to stay off that brake, save your stuff to the end of the race, and he may have an opportunity to get this Roush car back into victory lane.
McMurray completes the pass as Martin gives him the low groove entry into turn three. Just up ahead of them, Elliott Sadler.
Yeah, I've been watching this 38 car, qualified in the seventh position. Tommy Ball and the crew chief, they built a brand new race car, like Dale Jarrett, their teammate for this racetrack. They went to Caraway Speedway and tested it. You could not test here at Martinsville. Been pretty solid the entire weekend, sitting here now in the fifth position in the top five.
And Larry, the car looks good. I mean, it's not getting the back end hopping out. It doesn't look like it's real tight in the middle of the corner. It just looks like he's driving right now. Kind of pacing himself, almost looks like to me.
And Martinsville has not been good to Elliott Sadler. 14 starts, only two top tens here. So this is a good run for him in this race team.
And that's what you do when you're in the comfort zone like Elliott's in right now, not being pressured from behind. He's got a little room in front of him. You just ride. You got to put down some laps here. You can't race all the time. Your brakes won't take it.
Interesting group of lead lap cars here. Kurt Busch in the 2, his teammate Ryan Newman in the 12, and Ken Schrader in 11th place in the 21. Here's Matt.
Mike, whoever said that NASCAR racing is behind as far as technology goes need to reevaluate their observation of this sport, because 3 weeks ago, the 1999 Time Magazine Man of the Year and founder of Amazon.com, Jeff Bezos, and 9 rocket scientists paid a visit to Penske Racing. The reason? Their Blue Origin organization, which is trying to endure human presence in space and also work on commercialized passenger launching systems to go into outer space and visit the moon. They paid a visit to Penske Racing to look at their organizational setup, because 2 years ago, Jeff met Roger Penske as we got
trouble.
Spin on the racetrack, Mike.
Turn three, David Stremme has gone around. Stremme was a lap down, battling to try to get back. And the Lone Star Dodge spins around and gets going once again. Damage to the left rear corner. So that wasn't quite a rocket launch, Matt, but pretty damaging there for Stremme. Let's see what happened.
Stremme in the 40 is a lap down right here, racing with Ryan Newman in the 12, Kenny Schrader in the 21.
Whoops. Looked like Kenny was going down when Stremme was coming up.
Typical Martinsville.
Left front, right rear. Not good. That was just one of those deals, almost like, it was almost like if Stremme was saying, I'm going to go up to the outside, you go to the inside.
Definitely Kenny Schrader was going down, there's no question.
I tell you, sometimes you get confused on the hand signals. A driver will be pointing one way or another, and you think he means you're supposed to go that way, and he's saying he needs to go that way.
Bad news for Stremme, good news for Dale Jarrett. He's the free pass car, and the UPS Ford will go back up on the lead lap. Pit stops for some of the lead lap cars, beginning with Ryan Newman, also Bobby Labonte, Joe Nemechek, Sterling Marlin, Scott Riggs, Yaley, Vickers, Petty in, along with Reigns and Green.
Now this is where we start seeing cars get off sequence of each other, because all the leaders were on pit road back on lap 91, which is about 44 laps ago. So what these guys that are pitting right here hope is that we go on maybe 20 or 30 laps, we get another caution, knowing that all of our leaders, like Tony Stewart, Jimmy Johnson, they'll come to pit road and they'll get that track position. Tony Stewart just having a little fun with Brett Bodine in the pace car.
Matt.
Mike, to put a period on that story about the rocket scientist, now Jeff was so impressed with Roger Penske 2 years ago at the IndyCar race, he put it on his calendar to finally visit Penske's new shop in Mooresville, North Carolina. Then when they moved it over to Concord, so impressed with that shop and Penske's organizational skills,
and how they develop and utilize space technology within the Penske Racing organization. The rocket scientists were so impressed that they've already made a return visit on their calendar to learn more how Penske's team utilizes that technology. So they can do that. Maybe someday a race fan can go to outer space with technology learned from Penske Racing.
So I guess we can't look at this and say it's not rocket science anymore.
Oh, no. They went over to visit the Rocket Man.
Oh, that would be Ryan Newman. Dick Bergman.
Well, interesting stuff here with Jimmy Johnson, car number 48. Chad Knaus was on the radio to him under that caution flag, and he didn't just say pit once or pit twice. He said pit, 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 pit. But his driver stayed out. Chad said, why? Jimmy Johnson said because he'd looked at the rearview mirror and pretty much everybody was going to stay out. So Chad told him it was the right thing to do. Harken back to May of 2004 at the end of the race. They stayed out, car 48. Everybody else pitted. They wound up losing the race. Chad is ready to pit that car, whatever Jimmy may or may not be.
And we had 11 of our 27 lead lap cars pit that time.
Well, I just remember what Junior Johnson told me one time. Boy, you want to drive that car or you want to run these pits?
Ah. Next week, our Wendy's race menu takes us to Texas for the O'Reilly 300 presented by AOL. Saturday at 3 Eastern on Fox. Next Sunday, Nextel Cup Racing with the Samsung Radio Shack 500, 1:30 p.m. Eastern, right here on Fox.
Only 1 mile longer in length, but almost double the speeds what we have here.
Getting set for the restart after this fifth caution flag of the day. Two in turn one and one in each of the other corners. As you look at Martinsville Speedway from the air.
Line's getting a little shorter because we have all those cars that are one or more laps down, like Mark Martin in the sixth car trying to get back on the lead lap to the inside of all the lead lap cars.
Yeah, let's watch them go up to the gears here.
Will they restart, what, in second gear here?
Second gear, yeah.
So second, third, fourth.
And you're not in any of those gears. Second and third, not very long with that low gear in the back. You just launch pretty good, and you try getting high gear as quick as possible.
27 cars on the lead lap. The first two are Chevys, Stewart, and Johnson. And then a lap car, and then Casey Kane's Dodge.
There you see Jeff Gordon in that 24 car. He's about to crack back in the top 10. This is a battle for 10th with Kenny Schrader in the 21 car. Remember, a little bit fresher tires, about 20 lap fresher than most of these guys he's racing right now.
And don't forget, too, last year here he got three laps down and come back to win the race. So at the end of the longest line, still lead laps, no big deal for him.
Gordon brought out the third caution of the day at lap 89 when he cut down a right front tire.
And the reason he has fresher tires, though, is because since he was at the back of the pack on the next caution, he went ahead and came to pit road, got four fresh tires again. Riding with Michael Waltrip in the 55 car right now. Michael in the 31st position. One lap down, which we've got about five or six cars that are one lap down racing for that free pass to get back on the lead lap. Right now, Mark Martin in the six looks to be a shoe for that.
Now Mark had a lot of damage from that first turn accident on the second lap there. I think they've worked on it, got a little bit better.
It doesn't look any better, Terrell, but no. It sure works better.
He may have had another accident we didn't see.
And right now, Mark Martin is smart enough. He don't want to go up there and try to get back on the lead lap by passing leader. He's exactly where he wants to be, in touch with the leader, and he's the first car one lap down. You talk about emails, DW. I continue to get emails about the free pass. What the free pass is, if you are the first car one lap down behind the leader and the caution comes out, the field is frozen, so they let that first car get back on the lead lap, go all the way around the racetrack.
Three wide, turn two, and Bobby Labonte wisely backs out of the throttle as he and Kenny Schrader and Reed Sorensen were three abreast going into the corner. That won't work here.
Yeah, Reed really, he made it three wide going down there. I didn't think they were going to make it, but he is right there with Kenny Schrader and Bobby Labonte, and so they helped him out.
Now this is worth another look.
Watch Reed. He's in the inside on the 41 car. Here comes Bobby on the outside. He and Kenny say, well, kid, you go ahead. you go ahead.
Yeah, there'd be a place right at the exit of that corner where someone would lose a fender or two. Oh. A little bump there as Newman tried the inside on Labonte.
And Bobby Labonte in the 43, Ryan Newman in the 12, as well as Sterling Marlin in the 14. This is the first of the group of cars that made pit stops on that last caution to get four fresh tires. So their tires are about 45 laps fresher than like Reed Sorensen in the 41. And Darrell, as hot and slick as this racetrack is, fresh tires versus 45 lap tires, I know track position is important, but boy, I believe eventually those fresh tires will prevail.
Keyword eventually. Not a lot of difference over a while, but over the long haul, it'll pay off. We saw it in a truck race yesterday. David Starr won the truck race yesterday, and he must have run 150 laps on the same set of tires.
Bobby Labonte and Ryan Newman continue their battles side by side for 16th in the DirecTV 500.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by State Farm. Great service and great rates. You can get it all from State Farm. By Team Chevy and the 303 horsepower Monte Carlo SS. Chevy, an American revolution. By Subway Restaurants. Subway. Drive hard, eat fresh. And by Radio Shack. Tony Stewart leading as we hit lap 60 ahead of Jimmy Johnson. Time for a Visa race break of the DirecTV 500 at DirecTV, the sister company of Fox. That was a little help to rookie Cliff Boyer in the 07 DirecTV car involved in this 9-car wreck that included Dale Earnhardt Jr., who fell all the way back to 42nd. We'll update his progress in just a moment. Dale, Jarrett, Mark Martin also involved. Tony Stewart taking the lead from Jamie McMurray, who Jimmy Johnson led 27 laps. Tony Stewart now has dominated this race. Jeff Gordon, who was working in the top five, has a right front tire that goes down. Too early into the pits. Penalized for that. Moved back to as far as 22nd. Remember last year, he was three laps down, came back to win the race. Greg Biffle on lap 110, off of turn two. He was running in the top 10, but not anymore. Roush Racing has not had a lot of success here, but Jeff, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is moving up.
Yeah, he's moving up. He's been in a pretty good battle here between he and Kevin Harvick, but after that first incident back here on lap two, really, and started this race, he's done a great job of keeping that car up front, working through the field, but pretty good battle here, and the 29 starting to put some pressure really on Jeff Gordon, and I'm really curious to see if he gets around Gordon, he'll be right behind Kurt Busch, and as DW talked about early on today, sparks could fly when these two guys get together.
Well, and we've gone, and the 21 car with a problem.
He's headed down pit road right there. Kenny Schrader running really good today in that 21 car, the Wood Brothers here from Virginia.
So far, though, tempers have been cool on a warm spring day in Martinsville.
And right now, talk about how hot it is. Kenny Schrader's coming down pit road with his oil temperature's gone up to about at 320 degrees. It looking they're going to try to pull some, put some water in it. Running kind of hot, it looks like.
This has been a Visa race break, and no matter what it takes, life takes Visa. And Mike, did I mention this was the DirecTV 500?
I think you did. You probably should point out DirecTV and Fox Sports are owned by the same parent company and have the same chairman. So happy to have David Hill with us here today. And hello to all of you watching on DirecTV, which includes the crews and the motor coaches and even NASCAR next door.
Guarantee everybody takes advantage of it.
Schrader had been smoking out the right exhaust pipe for some time, and he's now taken the Little Debbie's Ford behind the wall. The number 21.
Four car's got something dragging. I don't know if he's cut down a tire or
turn one.
Something's wrong here. I think
left
it's
front.
A left side tire.
Scott Wimmer looks like he will make it to pit road. Definitely looks like a left front down.
Yeah.
Maybe completely all but gone off the wheel. We do not, since it's a short track, we do not run that safety inner liner that you've heard Jeff Hammond talk a lot about at the Ford cutaway car. It's basically the tire mounted on the rim.
Yeah, it's so much heat in the tires here that the inner liner would just add to that. So I think that's one of the reasons we don't run them.
Wimmer will get back out after a change of tires. Tony Stewart now almost 2 seconds up on Jimmy Johnson, Matt.
Mike, it doesn't really seem to matter what profession. Everyone can always use a little help trying to achieve their goals. Now, Timmy Lattiga, crew member on the 48 of Jimmy Johnson, met a young man named Daniel Hamrick 8 years ago. He met him Wash's career going
turn
up
four,
to the
Matt, excuse me, Mark Martin has been spun around. And that puts us under caution for the sixth time today.
Now that's going to be interesting right there, because those two were battling to be the first car a lap down to who can get the free pass. So I'm anxious to see what the results are going to be. I got a feeling we may not have a free pass.
Go ahead, pull off. It's 32. Go ahead, Joe.
As the rule is applied, if Mark was the first car one lap down and he's involved in the caution, then you're right, no free pass, Larry. Here it is with Casey Mears.
These guys have been going at it for quite a while. I think Casey was actually a little quicker than Mark Martin for the last few laps, and right there on the throttle off turn four gets in the back of Mark, and boy, Mark Martin, fourth in points, had a rough day so far.
Let's see now, the difference of Martinsville and Bristol, he didn't hit anything.
Right.
Cranks it up, takes off again. Bristol, you'd be back
in the
wall.
In front of you, drifter up high, drifter up high.
Fuel cell would be up against the back of your seat.
Jamie McMurray waving, slowing down, accident ahead. And now, pit road's open, and here come the leaders.
It will be busy.
Jeannie?
Busy in the pit of the five car of Kyle Busch. A lot of discussion of the car, a little loose on entry and past the center. Talk here to tighten this one up. Four tires, a wedge adjustment, and fuel. Matt?
Tony Stewart already in his box. Work completed on the left side. Todd Foster coming around the left rear. Tony Stewart having a very typical Martinsville type day for Stewart. Still needs a little bit of help on the forward bite. Dick?
Jimmy Johnson also looking for more forward bite. They're going to try to fix that with the air pressure. So far, no one has passed it. But here comes Tony and a bunch of others. Let's see if he beats them out. He does. Jimmy Johnson's going to be leading this race.
Tony second, Casey Kane third, Kyle Busch comes out in fourth.
I mean, we talk about it all the time, a 500-lap race, but sitting on the pole here can be worth so much because of that number one pit selection you see right there. He wins the battle off pit road. Now, I do need to mention, we had three cars that pitted back on lap 135, Sterling Marlin, Jeff Green, and J.J. Yaley. They did stay out that time. That's the caution they were looking for, is to basically get that track position.
Here's the race off pit road.
Jimmy Johnson, there you see Tony Stewart in the 20, just barely beating Casey Kane. Kyle Busch in the 5 maintains the fourth position as well. Now when they drop the jack, just look, he just has to go from here to win that battle off pit road. Look at these guys stacked up back here.
And Larry, you were right, there is no free pass car. Mark Martin was in that position, but because he was the incident, there is no free pass. It's been a busy day at Martinsville. Again, we'll show you where the cautions all came. We're up to six. We're only 174 laps in.
Got a few
to the DirecTV 500. We're back under green. Casey Mears and Carl Edwards have both raced past then leader Sterling Marlin to get back on the lead lap. But look at these teammates fight for the lead. Tony Stewart and J.J. Yaley side by side traded paint, and then Stewart went back in front.
I mean, it was some big time racing.
Whoa, Jimmy Johnson got in there, hit the curb, got up into the 18 car. Boy, that backed everything up.
He's going to lose a position to Casey Kane in the 9, as well as his teammate Kyle Busch in the 5.
He may have done a little damage to that car, Larry. I tell you, he was hitting around there pretty hard.
And even 10 car lengths back, there was contact. Matt Kenseth and Michael Waltrip as a result.
Well, he's lucky he didn't cut a tire down, because he got into JJ.
Show you how this all developed. 14, Sterling Marlin is the leader. And here comes Yaley on the inside in the 18.
And remember, the 20, Tony Stewart, Jimmy Johnson, 48. Little fresher tires in the 18 and 14 car.
Yaley gets the lead, and here comes Stewart. Little brush there. And
Jimmy
then
goes down into 3 really hard. I thought he got on the curb, but I think he just actually got real loose trying to stay off of JJ and got the car sideways. Cost him a bunch of spots.
Trouble for Bobby Labonte. The Petty car slow on pit road. Richard Petty's taken that number 43 to 15 checkered flags here at Martinsville. Labonte in trouble before we get to halfway here.
It's See, Jimmy Johnson in the 48 drives by J.J. Yaley in the 18. It was a battle for the fourth position.
Martin Truex in the Bass Pro Shops number one, way up and out of the groove. And now he's got to clean his tires back off as Kurt Busch goes by. 26 cars on the lead lap, including Carl Edwards, who raced past Sterling Marlin after they dropped the green on this restart, to race his way back onto the lead lap.
43 car must have had an engine failure because he's taking that baby behind the, into the garage.
I tell you, another car having a good run. He runs behind his teammate right here, Jeff Burton, up in the 31 car, but I'm talking about Kevin Harvick in the 29 car. Started in 29th position, got that top five last week at Bristol. That was his first top five since Richmond, May of last year. Another good run today for these Richard Childress cars.
Genie is in Harvick's pit as we watch Bobby Labonte climb out for the second week in a row.
Disappointing, but not for Kevin Harvick, who's just keeping his nose down and just keeps driving. They just keep telling him, steady progress, steady progress. This last stop, no changes right now. That's pretty much what Kevin asked for. He said the car is good. They just got four tires and fuel. He's happy, making steady progress.
Well, let's keep an eye on this because NASCAR's war of words the last couple of weeks have involved these two cars, Kevin Harvick in the two, and Kurt Busch in the two, Kevin Harvick in the 29.
But it's been a one-sided war of words. Kurt Busch, I know they kept talking about it in the media center after the race last week, and he just said, kept saying, thank y'all for congratulating me for winning.
Dick Bergman.
Well, last year, Bobby Labonte was leading this race with another team with less than 100 laps to go, and it was engine failure. They've just pushed his car down pit road into the garage. What happened to it, Bobby?
The transmission broke. It's not quite strong enough for here in Martinsville, I don't think.
Okay, they're going to try to fix it for sure. What a disappointment.
And the 20 team up front, out front, leading again. Now, when that fierce battle, Mike Joy, was going on for the lead, Tony Stewart's radio completely silent. And then after he retook the lead, started motoring away, he says, you might want to check the right front fender. There may be some cosmetic damage. The car still drives fine, steering wheel still straight, but you might want to take a look at that right front fender when we stop next time. You may need to make a little tug and pull it back out.
Looks like it's got a little kink in it, well up above the center line of the tire.
Yeah, I don't think he has any issue whatsoever there.
You know, something else that was going on while we had all that side-by-side racing, Carl Edwards in the 99 has had a rough day. He got by the leaders and almost has a straightaway lead over Tony Stewart in the 20. But what that does, that puts Carl Edwards on the tail end of the lead lap. Carl Edwards in the 99, as well as Casey Mears in the 42, would love to see a caution right now. Both of them would be well back on the lead lap.
Carl looks like he's got one of those cars, as long as he can use the whole racetrack, kind of go where he wants to. Looks like it runs pretty good, but when he gets in traffic.
I want to make sure we mention Greg Biffle is back out on the racetrack right now, 62 laps down after making repairs to his car.
We also better mention Kyle Busch because he is coming toward the front. He's 1.8 seconds off the lead, and he's moved his way up to third.
All the Hendrick cars are running good today. The 5, 24, 48, they're all right there.
Well, at the risk of drawing another caution flag, let's go back to Matt.
Now, Mike, to put a period on the Timmy Lattica story, he's one of those crew members that helped Jimmy Johnson get off pit road to retake that lead. Now, he was so impressed not only with the go-kart driving of young Daniel Hemric, but also just the young man himself. So he wanted to help him further his racing career. Timmy actually sold his 1999 Mustang GT Anniversary Edition to raise the money to help this young man buy a Legends car. He's running the Bandolero Series, Larry Mack, out at the Lowe's Motor Speed with a summer shootout like your son Brandon did. Now he has a new Legends car. Timmy will run it a couple times, but he just felt like you've seen it so many times. A young driver with so much talent just needed a little bit of a boost. So Timmy Lattica went to his wall to help this young man out. He's a fine little driver. We'll have to keep our eyes to see. Maybe someday he'll be racing here at Martinsville.
We crossed 200 laps for Tony Stewart, Casey Kane, Jimmy Johnson, and the rest of the 25 cars on the lead lap. But Kyle Petty is not one of them.
Kyle slowed out here on the racetrack going down the front, and man, he drives in there and look what he sees.
Rear end trouble has put Kyle Petty behind the wall.
So you got a transmission on the 43, and now you got a rear end on the 45.
All within about 12 or 15 laps of each other. Looked like he was telling the crew, hey, I've got a gear burning up in this thing. I've got gear problems.
Tony Stewart in front of Casey Kane by 8/10 of a second. 202 laps complete in the DirecTV 500.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by Singular, raising the bar. By the all-new 2006 Ford Fusion, put your life in drive. By McDonald's. And by Visa. Go on, live life, and remember that no matter what it takes, life takes Visa. Tony Stewart, who led first at lap 34, lost the lead momentarily, has recaptured and led most of the laps and has moved from 22nd up to 9th in the points in the last three races, leading here on lap 211. Casey Kane running right behind him right now would be your points leader ahead of Jimmy Johnson. But how about the 41 car?
Hey, the 41 car, we got a pretty impressive rookie battle getting ready to develop here between the 18 of J.J. Yaley and the 41 of Reed Sorensen. And Reed has actually just passed J.J. for that position. And I've been watching this young man. Again, another one of those rookies that never seen Martinsville. And early on this week, I mean, he was kind of walking around, kind of trying to figure out how to get around this racetrack. But he looks really smooth, letting the car roll through the middle of the corner, accelerating up off. But he's really putting down some pretty impressive lap times and making them, you know, doing a good job.
Jeff Gordon has worked his way back up tonight. The Dale Earnhardt Jr., who was 42nd at one time, is currently running 8th.
Yeah, right now he's really looking good. Also, with this damage on the right front, but it's really not slowing him down very much at all.
So Reed Sorensen, your highest rookie at 11th, followed by J.J. Yaley at 12th. And earlier in this race, some of the rookies have had some problems on this short track.
Oh, a lot of them have had problems early on. I mean, we take a look at David Stremme. He got caught up in an early accident, 07 of Clint Bowyer. He also had trouble along with Martin Truex Jr. So it's been tough on some, and other ones are making it look easy.
Let's rejoin Daryl, Larry, and Mike.
I like the race that took.
That's
if you look at the rookie points here.
Together right there. Good job.
As you ride with Carl, Clint Bowyer.
Tell you what, Chris Myers just mentioned Dale Earnhardt Jr. and the 8 car was involved in that lap 2 crash. He just drives by Jeff Burton in the 31, takes over the 6th position. So, again, I just got to believe part of it's keeping that right front tire cool.
Certainly not hurt anything on these long runs. Everything that's happened to that car has happened to it. It's helped it. Got air going in the right front. That's a good thing. Got the grill open a little wider. That's a good thing. And you got no rear bumper holding the thing, no drag down the straightaway. So he aerodynamically has fixed that car.
Right behind Junior, the 7th place battle is a good one where Jeff Burton is trying to hold off last week's winner, Kurt Busch. And they were side by side a lap ago. Now Burton has prevailed for the moment. You see that big black strip of rubber down in the concrete of the corners, Daryl?
Yeah, well, what you're noticing is some guys try to run below that, some guys try to run above it, some guys straddle it, and the 42 looked like he was off the pace there off turn 2. But that's what happens here. The longer you run, that rubber buildup. Yeah, he's in the trouble there.
He made it to pit road.
Clear.
He made it to pit road.
Gear broke.
It's another gear broken. We remember Kyle Petty in the 45 car, gear problems just about 20, 25 laps ago.
Well, just remember, you got 800 plus horsepower, and you are digging it up out of the corner here with a pretty low gear, and the gear sometimes just won't take it.
Now, both the cars with rear end trouble are Dodges, but don't all these cars run the 9-inch Ford rear end?
Yeah, rule out, unless it's body or engine problems, rule out manufacturer, because okay, every car runs the same type of, basically the same type of transmission and gear.
Let's look at the two different lines that Tony Stewart and Casey Kane are running. Tony's going to run the curb. I mean, he's right on the bottom. The reason is, here he goes right here. That's Tony. The reason is he wants to run the bottom is he wants to stay under all that black stuff, that rubber buildup. The 9 car, on the other hand, he wants to go above it.
And Darrell, I think he's going above it more down in turn three and four than one and two.
Yeah, he's getting a great bite off of turn four because of where he's running. He's running a much higher line. Right now he's trying to get underneath of, I think that's Michael in front of him. You see Jimmy Johnson sticking his nose there. Here comes Jimmy on the outside. And Jimmy's moved up as well, trying to get above that rubber buildup. You see there how high he is. That black streak is just build up of rubber, and it makes the car very hard to handle.
Casey Kane let Jimmy go and is losing touch with him. Kane's car has slowed a bit, Darrell, suddenly.
But just remember, I saw good, the car, Jimmy Johnson's car had good bite in that second groove right there. We're 225 laps into this race. Remember when we started the race, you couldn't go anywhere up there in that second groove.
And now it's your, pretty much, once somebody does it, Casey Kane started it, spotters start telling their drivers, Kane's making time on the leader, running high, tried running high, and the next, oh!
Oh, Burton and Busch.
Man.
Caution's out.
That was a battle for position.
A little bad blood there.
Yeah, that's not going to be good.
Caution is out right now.
That looked like it could have been avoided to me.
Seventh yellow flag of the day. And we had shown you earlier that those two cars were battling for seventh or eighth place. Jeff Burton, who had a good car today, and Kurt Busch, last week's winner. Carl Edwards will get the free pass.
Now, Burton is still on the lead lap. He got going before the Tony Stewart, the leader, came around there, so he's still on the lead lap.
Guys, pitch her over.
Most of that damage is to the rear of the car. They may be able to fix that. Let's see if we can tell what happened here.
She's going off into turn three right here.
I think that's actually, is it three or one? Turn three?
Burton on the 31 on the outside. The two car just moved up the racetrack.
Tried to drive in underneath them hard enough to get the position, and he just got into him.
And pit road is a very busy place. Jeannie Zelasco.
Yes, it is for one young Kyle Busch in the five car. The car a little bit free everywhere, so they're going to make some air pressure adjustments. And four tires and fuel. Matt?
And Tony Stewart already in. Crew going to work on the left side. The car very strong on that last run. And real quick, Busch said the pedal went all the way to the floor, Dick.
Casey Kane was just told before this caution flag, literally moments before, that he should move his line up. Kane, concerned about overusing his brakes on the car, said he can't get into the corners as well as he might like to.
Three wide on pit road. Real big squeeze play coming down to turn one, and finally that group breaks. Real knot of cars right here.
I love the race off pit road.
Did you see the left side tires on that 48 car? They look like they're flat. Watch them when they come off pit road here.
See again, we may see a lot of room between Kurt Busch's car and the curbing going down in that corner.
Now, you see what happened is he got loose getting in, and Burton moved up to give him the inside. I think he drove in a little too hard, got loose, and spun into him.
You could definitely see he was turned back to the right slightly, the car getting loose in the corner.
And Burton's going to be Burton now feels really bad because I gave him the inside, drove in there too hard, and wrecked me.
Inside, two inside. And a two just spun it.
We restarted three laps ago. Jimmy Johnson leading Casey Kane and Tony Stewart. Last time by at turn four, Stewart jumped underneath Kane, just like Kyle Busch is trying to do now. And that's dropped Kane to third, right in front of the younger of the Busch brothers. Now Kevin Harvick's up for fifth.
These cars are pretty evil right now. They only got about 7 or 8 pounds of air in that left side tire. So it takes 4, 5, 6 laps for the pressure to build up for the thing where you can drive it.
Just got to hang on till then.
So Jimmy Johnson is out in front for the second time today. We listened in.
You ready? Kick it, kick it, kick it, kick it. One outside. Go, 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 go. Yes. Good job, guys.
Boys, you are right on today.
That's great work.
Now that was getting out of the pits.
And that was Earl Barbin, the spotter, being a spotter and being a cheerleader as well.
Oh, yeah. Casey Kane's going to try it again, this time on the low side. Kyle Busch, Casey Kane.
Kane's got that outside. I mean, he keeps inching up. I don't know how much higher he can go, but he gets a pretty darn good bite off the corner out there.
He got up a little too high that time, so he'll lose that third position to Kyle Busch in the five.
I think that's a later on groove. Later on in the race.
Tell you what, right behind this group right here, you see Dave Blaney in the 22 car, one lap down. We're riding with Kevin Harvick in the 29 in the fifth position, but right behind him, and remember, back on lap 89, had a flat tire on the green, got the caution, Jeff Gordon in the 24, restarted all the way at the back of the pack areas, back up to the sixth position, and we're not even halfway yet. 11 laps shy of halfway.
Now Kevin Harvick now up for fifth place, just ahead of Gordon. Here's Jeannie.
Watching Kevin Harvick today, it's like a shark circling, methodical. Actually, he's been relatively quiet on the radio coming into this last stop. The largest discussion really of the day, his crew chief Todd Barrier said, "What can we do to help you?" Kevin replied, "Nothing. Leave it alone." Dick?
Well, Casey Kane came on the radio shortly after the green flag fell and asked his crew if they did what he had wanted them to do with his tires. He doesn't like the air pressure in him, doesn't like the way the car is behaving. Car number 12, Ryan Newman, is stuck way back in traffic. He had to make two separate pit stops. The first pit stop under caution, they changed his two tires. He came back in for two more. Why? They weren't sure exactly where the pace car was, afraid that they might lose a lap. So they did it twice rather than once.
David Stremme and Kyle Petty had both returned to the race, and now they both return to the garage.
The garage is getting very crowded right now. I want to go back and talk about Kevin Harvick in the 29 car. I talked to Richard Childress last night. We had dinner over at his winery down near Lexington, North Carolina last night, and he said Kevin was really complaining about the engine off the corner yesterday practice. But Darrell, this racetrack is much slicker than it was yesterday morning. I've got to believe if it was a little weak off the corner yesterday morning, it could be just right for today.
It could be, and there's a number of things you can do. You can play with throttle linkage, play with headers, tailpipes. There's a lot of things you can do to help the engine accelerate a little bit better. Maybe they made some adjustments on it.
But you know what Robert Yates used to always ask Davey Allison? He'd complain about the engine off the corner. Can you mat it and stay in it?
Yeah.
Eighth place race. Elliott Sadler just got by Kurt Busch. Here comes J.J. Yaley.
Now, Kurt's car is not near as this pit stop. They made some sort of an adjustment, and that car is not quite as good as it was before he had the contact with Jeff Burton.
Now, the man that couldn't even find the racetrack 3 days ago, J.J. Yaley, in that 18 car, still up there in the lead lap in the 10th position. First time to ever come to Martinsville. Here he's battling Kurt Busch in the two for ninth.
And they'll go past Jeff Burton, who is going to limp his car back to pit road as a consequence of damage.
But I think back on lap 170, when Steve Adick and his crew chief left him on the racetrack, got the track position, and then we went to lap 225, and everyone pitted, it paid off.
One thing about that two car, if he's having brake issues, he can't drive the thing off in the corner like he needs to. He may be fighting a brake problem right now because he's losing position pretty quickly. The only way you can get your brakes back here is you got to slow down, ride a while, keep the foot off of them, let them cool off, let the fluid all cool off, pump them and get some air, get the air out of them, and go at it again.
He's about to be caught by the 12th place battle. Reed Sorensen inside on the 41, and Jamie McMurray almost brushing the wall.
Yeah, you can tell
26.
Almost like he's got a brake problem. See how they close on him getting into the corner? He's all right off. He pulls off the corner well, but they close on him really fast getting to the corner.
Time for our next singular virtual crew chief question. As Jeff Burton exits the pit, will Hendrick Motorsports claim its sixth win in the last seven Martinsville races? Right now, their drivers are first and third and sixth and 17th. 251 laps into the DirecTV 500.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by DirecTV. NASCAR driven by DirecTV. hours of racing, almost 2 hours here in Martinsville. Tony Stewart has led the most laps, took it from Jamie McMurray on lap 34. Jeff Gordon, seven-time winner here, swept this race last year, running in the top five, but then had a tire problem, right front tire, into the pits too early, penalized. Fell all the way back to 26th, is now up to sixth. Mark Martin bumped by Casey Mears. Martin has said this is not his favorite racetrack. That loosened things up. Meanwhile, Petty Enterprises having problems.
Yeah, they had problems in their driveline first. Bobby Labonte loses the transmission, goes behind the wall, and right after that, here comes Kyle Petty, his basically owner and teammate. He loses the rear gear, and he has to go to the garage here and have that changed.
Seventh caution coming out. Jeff Burton, who had some harsh words last week for Kurt Busch, who won in Bristol, and Kurt Busch drives hard into him here. Is this careless or accidental?
Brakeless, maybe, Chris. I mean, we heard a report already that possibly he had a brake problem, so he may have got into him because of lack of brakes. And again, you take a look here. Here's the 8 car going to the inside of Jeff Gordon, and he's had a phenomenal recovery, moving all the way back up to 6th position as he passes the 24 car. And another guy's been having a little bit of a rough day today. Look at the brake rotor right on the right front. You see the fire coming around that brake rotor, running on the racetrack, and that's what happens when you lose the brakes. You cannot control your race car. Let's watch him as he goes around the racetrack here. Goes down in the corner, can't keep it down way high, gets up in the loose stuff, gets his tires covered with all that rubber. A lot of trouble right there. When you lose your brakes, I mean, you're basically just kind of out there on a wing and a prayer.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr., as you get a look from the 07 car, the DirecTV 500 race here in Martinsville. Jr. was as far back as 42nd. Now he's moved up to 5th, just in front of Kevin Harvick. And pole sitter Jimmy Johnson, Mike, is your leader.
Yeah, Jr. made that pass one lap ago on Harvick to move into the top five.
And we do need to mention most of our gear and transmission repairs are complete from the garage area. Casey Mears in the 42 back out there, 43 laps down. Kyle Petty, heard Jeff Hammond talking about him and Bobby Labonte, both the Petty cars back out there, 59 and 61 laps down.
If you watch the 8 car, he's running above that rubber buildup. Watch when we go down in the corner here, you see all that black, that's rubber buildup. It's like little speed bumps. It got brrrr when you hit it. I watched down here in 3 and 4. It's really worse down here. And he's got to go way up above it. He wants to get his left side tires just touching that. Right sides are clean. You get a good forward bite that way off the corner.
And when he moved up about 20 laps ago, that's when he started making some ground. And I've been watching our scoring monitor. He's about a tenth of a lap quicker than the top four cars out there, Johnson, Stewart, Kyle Busch and Casey Kane. Jeannie, the 8 car, they have figured something out.
Yeah, I think what they've figured out is the running joke today, by the way, in the pits, that they may knock the front bumper off their car before every single race. So this week they can laugh about it because things are going well. Curiously enough, Tony Year Jr. came on the radio several laps back saying, you know what, we've got the winning car here. Just let things shake out and just get going. And that's exactly what we're seeing Jr. do.
Yeah, Jeannie, his car just keeps, I mean, he's not getting loose off the corner at all. Watch Casey Kane right in front of him. Casey can't get power down. When he does, the back end steps out. Junior's just coming up off there, nose up in the air and moving forward.
The car turns good. Boom, right there. The car turns and rotates, and he's able to keep the throttle down like you said.
I like it, Junior. You keep digging, buddy. You're going to have the lead here in a little while.
17th place, Jeff Green in the 66, Dale Jarrett and Joe Nemechek. Remember, Jarrett got the free pass back on the lap 133 caution and has had a nice comeback after starting the race pretty well out of shape.
Yeah, his car was terrible when they started, but they've done a good job in the pits of adjusting him up, and he's hanging in there pretty well right now.
And Jeff Green got the free pass back on lap 89 as well.
Overactive adrenaline disorder, that's OAD, a quality Ford race drivers possess, all Ford drivers. Here are Ford's biggest movers of the race. So far, Dale Jarrett up 10 spots from where he started, Matt Kenseth and Mark Martin.
Just remember, Dale Jarrett, he's sitting 10th in the points right now in the Nextel Cup points.
His teammate Elliott Sadler has been running the top 10 all day. Larry, the 38 car, sitting there in 8th place right now. Both cars are working pretty good for them.
Both of them bringing brand new race cars here. Just shook them down in a little short track Caraway. Elliott Sadler, the 38 car, right now in the eighth position.
Probably can run a little different car here than you do anywhere else, geometry-wise. A lot of guys like to run a, what we call a drop snout car here. It can be a three-quarter, it can be an inch and a half. Got a little different geometry. Really is good getting down in the corner.
That was a good lap there.
The lead of Jimmy Johnson has disappeared. Tony Stewart is there. Traffic had something to do with that. Now it has a lot to do with that as Johnson comes up on the back bumper of Ryan Newman and Bobby Labonte just ahead.
Yeah, these guys aren't, you know, I mean, Ryan Newman certainly going to pull over and let Jimmy Johnson in the 48 go by.
And I'm going to tell you guys, we've been watching this 12 car, Ryan Newman, all day long as he's just about, as you mentioned, about to fall to a lap down to our leader. The 12 car, they have definitely lost something in their performance. They basically were not that good at Bristol last week, didn't run that well in Atlanta, really struggling this year.
I think they confused themselves messing around with that Intrepid. And I think they got off there, got kind of focused on that, and I think they really got to get back in here and work on this Charger and make that happen.
Traffic ahead for Jimmy Johnson as he clears Ryan Newman and Tony Stewart starts to look in. Contact in turn three between two former teammates, Joe Nemechek and Scott Riggs.
Boy, watch the leaders coming here. There's Jimmy Johnson. Here comes Tony. He just whoa'd up. But the real battle right there is between that red car 99 and 14. They're battling over who's one lap down to get the free pass. And I don't know how that turned out.
It all depends on where they were when the field was frozen at the time the caution was displayed. But that 0-1 of Joe Nemechek, Scott Riggs, and the 10 were battling for position still on the lead lap. But a lot of damage to the Army car, Joe Nemechek.
Battle no more today.
And NASCAR, according to the scoring loops around the racetrack, are saying that Sterling Marlin will get the free pass. There's Riggs, little brake lockup coming into the corner, gets into Nemechek. And can't control his own car, he goes around as well.
Much like what we saw with the 20, the 2 and the 31. Got down under him, got too much brake, got loose, got into him.
Well, I know pit road will be very busy because it's been about 70 laps since our leaders were on pit road. We've got about 18 cars on the lead lap.
And we're told the 9 of Casey Kane has dropped the cylinder, so he's running on 7 cylinders, but still a lead lap car. Jeannie?
Junior coming on the radio just prior to the stop saying, I'm not quite sure what to do because the car is tight on the first part of the run, but doing better. So don't look for any major adjustments here, but we are calling for 4 tires and fuel.
Now, look how far he pitted back in his pit stall. Reason, Reed Sorensen in the 41 in front of him is still on the lead lap, but Matt, that gives him a good way to get out.
Larry Mack, Tony Stewart was analyzing his car, comparing it to the 48 of Jimmy Johnson. Stewart says that his car, as the 5 pulls alongside, says his car not quite as good through the center of the corner as the 48. They went back on the adjustments. Nick?
Jimmy Johnson has just had pit stop that could have been a lot better. Rear tire changer, Tim Latiga, fell coming around the car, and that is going to cost him a couple of positions. They did wind some weight, some static weight into the right rear spring, that to try to make the car turn a little bit better. It's pushing a little bit in the corners.
See right there, lost 2 positions. Tony Stewart in the 20, they win the battle off by gaining 1 position. This is your pit road time, including a pit stop. Kyle Busch in the 5, as well as Matt Kenseth in the 17 crew, having a faster time.
Tire changer falls down, you still come out 3rd. That's not too shabby.
Too bad. There's the race off pit road. You see Tony Stewart just barely inching out Kyle Busch in the 5.
I thought Johnson the 5 was actually ahead of Tony over there because Tony passed him in the curve. Come around the back and whoops.
Probably stepped in gas back there that had been spilled possibly.
Working the 8th caution flag of the day in Martinsville.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by AOL. Want a better high-speed internet? You belong at AOL. By Diet Dew. All the dew, no calories. How dew does diet? By Napa Auto Parts. Napa, get the good stuff. And by FedEx. Every day is race day.
Back under green, and we're racing side by side for fifth place. Kevin Harvick, Jeff Gordon going at it.
And what happened? Kevin Harvick, we're riding with him. He got boxed in behind Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8, opened the door for Jeff Gordon in the 24 on the bottom about a lap and a half ago.
But as you can see, I mean, we're 300 laps into this race. And
Whoa! Wow. Gordon moved up the racetrack.
Like I said, we're 300 laps into the race. Tension, the pace is picking up.
And all of these cars he's in the middle of right there, Scott Riggs in the 10, Dave Blaine in the 22, they are one or more laps down.
Plus, Darrell, every restart's a chance to get a fresh handful of steering wheel.
Hey, on fresh tires, let's see what happens here. He goes in. Ooh, the old crossover move. Little slight contact, not anything serious.
But it almost looked like the 24 car went up the racetrack ever so slightly. Like we've seen a lot today.
Well, if you drive in real hard, if you got room to go up, you will. But if you don't, you get into the guy beside you. He kind of did a little bit of both.
Tell you what, Denny Hamlin in this 11 car, he was involved in that wreck back on lap 2. He got the free pass back on lap 110. He's sitting here in the top 10 in the 9th position. Denny Hamlin, who has one start here back in the fall.
And ran a great race, and he's on it again today. And he loves this racetrack. He's run here quite a bit in the late model stock cars.
And old car's pretty clean.
Yeah, not bad.
Ooh, his teammate just got into Reed Sorensen. Jamie McMurray hit him. Brian Vickers hit Jamie. And everybody got straightened out.
And Kurt Busch went by them all. All in the front, 800 feet down the front straightaway, and that much happened in 800 feet.
Folks, the only way to see it all here is to buy a ticket. We'll show you everything we can. But this is a great place to come to and see a race.
Now
it starts up here.
There's a little bump from the 18 into the 41, then the 26, and then the 25. Then the 96 gets out there.
And like you say, Kurt Busch in the 2 goes by them all.
There he goes. He ain't done. He dives down under
Boyer.
Boyer.
Now, this happened about the same time.
Whoops.
Excuse me. Pardon me.
Yes.
And the 11 just got moved by Mark Martin, and perhaps that had something to do with the move you just saw.
I would say probably so. And Jimmy Johnson in the 48 car just went by his teammate Kyle Busch in the 5. That was a battle for second position. While these guys have been battling, our leader Tony Stewart in the 20 out at about a second lead right now over these guys.
Still 19 cars on the lead lap, and right in the middle of it, Jamie McMurray, the inside of Denny Hamlin, who drops from 10th now to about 14th.
Almost looks like something happened to the car. I guess he's up on the outside. No, I think he may have some of that contact. He may have done something to the car, possibly a tire going down.
Hey, you see Brian Vickers in the 25 car right there.
There he goes.
Hard in the outside wall.
Something happened to that car, that contact. I think he probably cut a tire down.
Flat tire caution is out here at lap 307.
That'll be the 9th one today. And that may be a break for Casey Kane. Kane is the free pass car.
You see that right rear is soft right there. It goes down in the corner.
This comes around with it.
It's confusing to the driver because the way he got shoved around, he wasn't sure if he had picked up a lot of buildup on his tire or if, in fact, he had a flat. Now he wishes he had thought I had a flat.
Pit road is open. No takers among the leaders.
It's only been 13 laps since that last restart, so not really surprising. Here actually comes Kurt Busch in the 2, Brian Vickers in the 25. It's a pretty hard lick to that outside wall by Denny Hamlin.
Yep.
Jeff Green is also in, Sterling Marlin and Dale Jarrett.
Clear.
We look at one more replay.
Going to hit the wall. Caution will be out.
Ninth caution flag today.
So
like the two cars going to do a little service here.
We're having a look back to see if there was one particular contact that might have caused that tire to go down.
Yeah, I think this is when it possibly happened. And of course, right here, more than likely, that was what caused the tire to be cut down.
.310 of 500 laps complete in the DirecTV 500. Tony Stewart remains your leader. We've just restarted with Tony Stewart up front, Jimmy Johnson, Kyle Busch, and the 8-car of Dale Earnhardt Jr. The Budd car is 4th, Jeff Gordon is 5th, Kevin Harvick 6th, Kenseth Sadler, Sorensen, and Mayfield are top 10.
I tell you, that old 8 car, if he's not using that bad boy up, and then if it's cooling like we think it is,
it's up on the curb,
that
the flam.
Good go.
Yellow.
Caution is out.
The one thing I was worried about is he has no protection for that right front tire. If he pokes somebody, he pokes them with the tire.
Well, they're going to have some serious work to do on the left front now because he did get into that inside wall.
Yeah, I guess a little wee bit. I think if they fix it like the other side, he'll be okay.
Come in, get 4 tires.
Chop that side off, boys.
Remember, Ryan Newman in the 12 car, a lap down, fighting Carl Edwards. Just comes down on Junior. Yeah. There's nowhere else for him to go.
Left him no room whatsoever. Just kind of cut him off. You can see Ryan's got, he's coming down hard.
Straighten up. You're good to go. Good to go.
I mean, no turn signal, nothing.
Just nope.
Left turn.
Start the left
front
a little bit, Tony Jr.
Yeah, please.
Good news for Carl Edwards. Edwards gets the free pass.
You remember Mexico when Kyle Petty wrecked Michelle Jourdain? I think that's kind of the reaction this crowd just gave a second ago.
Yeah, you, Kyle Busch.
Kyle Busch, yeah.
Yeah, Kyle Busch.
Jeannie.
Hand me the hammer. Not the words that they were expecting to hear in the A pit, at least for several laps now. They thought the bad stuff was behind them. You heard Junior talking about the left front being hurt a little bit. Junior actually not wanting to come in, but his crew chief coming on the radio saying, yes, we have to pit, but his car is not going to make it. So the hammer's hard at work, and they're putting 4 tires on, and he's going to have an uphill battle again today.
Well, Jack, we just what we were thinking, that things were looking up. Got his work cut out for him again.
We do need to mention Jeff Burton in the 31 car. He's going back out on the racetrack 73 laps down. Michael Waltrip just returned to the race.
Tony Stewart and the rest of the leaders stay out at 319 laps in the DirecTV 500.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by Allstate, official insurance sponsor of NASCAR.
10 caution flags. Turns 3 and 4 have become calamity corner. 7 out of 10 at that end of the speedway. Tony Stewart, Jimmy Johnson, Kyle Busch, Jeff Gordon did not pit. Here they go.
See if you can keep up with all this.
That's all at the same track, isn't it?
That's it. Same lap, same track.
Why don't we crank it up while we're doing that?
Why don't we?
Thank you.
complete this time by. Tony Stewart has clean air out front, and he's got a cushion. The lap car of Ryan Newman separating him from Jimmy Johnson, Kyle Busch, Jeff Gordon. Three Hendrick Chevrolets. Hendrick going for four in a row. They've won five of the last six here.
Yeah, Ryan Newman now is one lap down trying to get the free pass. Carl Edwards got it on the last caution.
Watching Junebug back in there, and his car's not right now. He's got his hands full. Looked like that did get some damage to the left front.
And Darrell, the car sounded flat coming up off the corner from his onboard. We listened in to Junior and crew.
It's going to be all right. Just give yourself a little room here and make sure you hit the brakes and don't rub. We lost a little bit of spots, but it ain't terrible. We went in worse today.
No, I can't keep knocking the front tires off his car.
Jeannie?
Tony Urey Jr. trying to calm him down. He also asked him, look, you'll be all right. You know, the steering wheel's still straight, right? Junior replied, no. Why do you think I'm so upset? And that's why we're seeing him out there with a handful right now.
Now, DW, I'm confused. Junior's telling his crew chief, I can't keep knocking the front tires off this car. Okay.
Well,
you got to share the misery. That's all I can tell you. He's going to blame the spotter before long. Been there, done that. If y'all don't do something. He's definitely in trouble now, though. The car looks like it's not near as good as it was.
I agree with you, Darrell. I think he was looking for some help from his spotter to keep him in a position where he wouldn't be getting into the back of people like that. But hard to do on a half mile like this. So, Hendrick Motorsports going for four in a row or six out of seven. Good chance, our viewers say. Their cars are second, third, and fourth. The first car owner to win four in a row at Martinsville, Carl Kiekhaefer with his Chrysler 300s, did it twice in 55 and 56. Holman Moody Fords did it twice, 63, 64, 65. Fred Lorenzen won all four. And Hendrick Motorsports has won five of six, and they're going for their fourth in a row. There's where their four cars are right now.
Pretty solid right now. There's one up right there, Brian Vickers in the 25 car. You know, Brian has been fast all weekend long. He just didn't cash in come qualifying, but he's hanging out on the lead lap
trouble.
Right here in 12.
Turnacek
goes around. Turnacek goes around again.
Caution is out. That's certainly the caution that Ryan Newman. Oh, I don't know, DW.
He'll be clear.
Oh. Yeah. Guess who gets it?
I think Casey Kane in the 9 may have got it because he's down a cylinder.
Exactly. That's the second time he's got an engine problem. Can't keep up. They just lap him, and he gets a free pass.
He's loving these caution flags.
Yeah,
he needs them being on seven cylinders.
Timing them perfectly. Good for him. That's got to be real frustrating for Ryan Newman, who's running decent, if he could just get back on the lead lap.
Watch the 0-1, the Army car, Niemicek.
Gets up out of the groove a little bit, and then...
They touched right there off of turn two.
Clear.
It has a tire rub right there. See the left front tire smoking on the front of the 01 Joe Nemechek's car. Darrell, possibly a similar situation that had to Denny Hamlin. Possibly the tire going down, the car just got loose with it.
I think the tire may have hung in the fender. Like he went in that corner and the tire got caught up in that fender that got bent and he couldn't correct it. You see a lot of smoke coming out as he goes down in the corner. I think that could have been a possibility.
Turn three and four has not been very good to Joe Nemechek over the last few laps.
Pit stops by Jeff Green, Brian Vickers, Carl Edwards, Sterling Marlin, and J.J. Yaley. Among the lead lap cars, Nemechek also pitted, along with Clint Bowyer, Tony Raines, Michael Waltrip, Greg Biffle, and others. Well, it's been a strange yet interesting day here at Martinsville Speedway, and here's the tale of the caution flags as far as where they occurred. Now watch this. OK, Okay, never mind that one right there. That's supposed to be an X. So is that. We've only had 11, but we've got room for more.
Don't worry. We've got 163 laps to go. We've still got eight numbers in the pot.
If you had just left those there, because I'm sure you could use them later. Just leave them there. We'll use them later.
It's a work in progress.
It is, but it's cool.
Hey, eight-year plan starting next year.
There you go.
Yep. It's only going to get better.
None of the leaders pit, and we'll have a restart next time by. 19 cars on the lead lap.
There's Mikey. Michael Curtis back there. He's in 31st place, 55 laps down.
DirecTV 500 race summary. After 338 laps, six leaders, eight lead changes, 11 caution flags for 60 laps. Tony Stewart will leave here having led the most laps, and we'll get the 5-point bonus for doing so.
Somebody's going to have to do something. Jimmy Johnson or the 5 car, they're going to have to do something if they're going to beat that 20 car. It's just a little bit better than all of them right now.
Now, one of our lead lap cars made a late caution pit stop there. Dale Jarrett, an 88 car, but Gene Zelasco was telling me a while ago they have battery and alternator issues. Not sure if they can make it to the end of this race. He's still on the lead lap, Dale Jarrett, the 88. Ryan Newman up there again in that 12 car, trying his best to get back on the lead lap one way or the other. He may be at the conclusion the only way I'm going to get it is just try to drive by the leaders, but that's going to be a tall order.
I see him. I can't. Got to keep going.
Jimmy Johnson cleared that lap car. Kyle Busch, Jeff Gordon, and all did not. Good strong day for Jeremy Mayfield. Ninth in the race right now. In the standings, the point standings, he would climb five spots to 29th. So a good day for Mayfield.
Looking for his first top 10 finish of the year here in 2006.
Well, if you got 160 laps to go, a lot can happen in 160 laps. I know if I was sitting out there right now, I'd be saying, I don't have anything yet.
Yeah.
I got a ways to go.
A lot of good cars behind him. McMurray, who started outside pole today in the 26. Kurt Busch in the 2. Earnhardt Jr., Carl Edwards, Jeff Green. Wide open in Texas next week, the Samsung Radio Shack 500.
Big boy racetrack.
Everything's bigger in Texas.
Big boy racetrack down there.
Very fitting we talk about Texas as we ride with Tony Raines, owners of this car, Roger Staubach and Troy Aikman.
Don't bring you wine and cheese down there, bring you work clothes.
Junior in 12th, he's knocked 3 out of 4 fenders off that car. He had a little help.
But he is still digging and still fighting.
Jeannie?
Yeah, fighting would be the operative part of that phrase. He came on the radio a short while ago and said he is most frustrated because he does not have that front bumper anymore. It has nothing to do with the situation with the tire and the brakes. It's because he can't administer any payback. Ugh.
No, he better not touch anyone with his front end now, Jeannie, because there's not a whole lot left up there to use right now.
Speaking of front bumper, did I read that NASCAR is going to change the front bumper regulations when we go to Talladega to eliminate slam drafting?
And I think it was inevitable that was going to happen. I saw it when we were in Atlanta a couple of weeks ago, and it's I don't think it's totally what they were looking for, but it's a step in the right direction.
Let me tell you something else, Larry. I was talking to Brett Bodine yesterday, and I've not been a big fan of the car tomorrow. I've been kind of down on the thing. But he told me that the car I saw about 6 months ago is a totally, they've got a brand new car now. And he was really, you can use a lot of the components off of our existing cars. Front snout, rear clip. It's only the center section of the car that's going to be totally different. That made me feel a lot better.
Yes, that's a big advance.
And when we come back here with the DirecTV 500 a year from now at Martinsville, NASCAR on Fox, this will be another race for the car tomorrow. In fact, they have a test schedule here tomorrow with several teams. Elliott Sadler to the 38 car, been solid all day long up in the sixth position. I was talking to Dick Bergman, though, earlier, and he talked like this car was running a little bit on the warm side. And they've taken all the tape off the nose of that car, Dick.
They sure have, and it's not just the engine that's running at 260 degrees. I just talked to Tommy Baldwin, and he said the brakes are overheated as well. Still, Elliott's hanging in there in sixth spot. Grill is completely clean. There's no debris on there. He's just running hot today. Everything hot.
All right, I want to go to my other crew chief over at the Hollywood Hotel, Jeff Hammond. We keep hearing about brake problems. Elliott Sadler, Michael Walter, Kurt Busch. The brakes just keep getting better and better. I'm not sure our cooling is keeping up with the amount of brakes these guys have. And you give them more brakes, what are they going to do?
They're going to use them more, Larry. That's just inevitable. Every time you give these guys something to go faster or stop better, well, they take it to the max. And that's what part of the biggest problem is. They are using these brakes harder than they ever have because they know they can get by with it because we got thicker pads and better brakes as far as calipers and rotor material.
And we're talking about brakes being overheated. How hot is it?
Over 1,300 degrees or better.
Wow.
I'll tell you what's heating up. We're going to have some battle for the lead here. All of a sudden, the 20 car is slowed, I think. Looks like Jimmy Johnson just caught a gear or something's happening to the 20. I'm not sure which.
Yeah, that last lap, Jimmy Johnson was a tenth and a half quicker than Tony Stewart in the 20 car.
Let's talk about brake temperatures and give you the range that we see on these cars and compared to your passenger car as well.
And remember, if any of those things go up in temperature, the engine particularly, it creates under the hood heat. And the more heat from the engine, the more heat to the brakes, the more heat to the tires, one thing leads to another. It's the sum of all parts.
We've seen that 1,300 degrees. It almost looks like molten lava inside that vehicle. But while these guys are really starting to race each other out here, Stewart and Jimmy Johnson, you see that yellow car back there, old Tony the Tiger in the five, Kyle Busch, he keeps creeping up. You know, everybody was always talking about the sophomore jinx coming into his second season, Kyle Busch, but so far it doesn't look like he's suffering from it.
That 20 car is giving me an indication that he has a brake. Maybe not a brake problem right now, but it's something going on with that car.
Well, Darrell, when you've led so many races here, when you can set the pace, why run the car any harder than you need to?
Well, when you brake with your left foot, that's the fast way to drive. But when I got out front like Tony is right now, I planted my left foot on my footrest, used my right foot only. Off the gas, on the brake. Off the brake, on the gas. That way I wasn't trying to use both of them at the same time, and that made the brakes last a whole lot longer.
They have retired the 11 car of Denny Hamlin. All the repairs in the garage area is completed. Everybody's back out on the racetrack except for the five cars that have loaded up.
Twelfth caution of the day. Look at the right rear of Jeff Green's SanDisk Best Buy Chevy from contact with the 14 of Sterling Marlin.
Opens the bottom up just a little. Sterling drives in too hard. See it time and time again here. That late entry into a corner here will just set you up to get wrecked.
Leaders are pitting. Jeannie.
29 to Kevin Harvick for the second time today. He says the car is too loose. When he picks up the throttle, they're going to make an air pressure adjustment. Four tires. Matt.
Bill Byrne and Gerald Shires were quickly making air pressure changes in the tires going on Tony Stewart Chevrolet. Shaggy Larson makes a chassis adjustment in the back. Dickey still needs help on late exit and rolling better through the corner.
Well, Jimmy Johnson doesn't need much help at all. They're making a very minor air pressure adjustment to his race car, and that's it. And once again, this lead pit stall has been a big help. He is the first one out of pit road.
There you see the race off pit road. Pretty much for the most part, the top four went out where they came in. You see Elliott Sadler in the 38 gained a position, as well as Dale Earnhardt Jr. Speaking of Elliott Sadler, his teammate, we'd mentioned Dale Jarrett in the 88 car, had the battery alternator problem. They decided with 134 laps to go ahead and change that battery. Problem here, they will go a lap down.
Scott Briggs got the free pass that time, and we'll get back on the lead lap. There's his Valvoline Dodge. Jimmy Johnson remains our leader, 368 laps in to the DirecTV 500.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by UPS, proud sponsor of Dale Jarrett's 88 Ford.
DirecTV 500 is delivered by UPS. UPS delivers the chance to manage your own free fantasy auto racing team and win two tickets to any Fox broadcast race. Go to foxsports.com, keyword UPS. We restarted with Jimmy Johnson in front on the second time by going into turn three. Tony Stewart powered past Johnson to put his Home Depot Chevrolet back out in front of the Lowe's Chevy. And right behind Johnson comes his young teammate, Kyle Busch, and the senior member of the Hendrick team, Jeff Gordon.
And Ryan Newman in the 12 is still trying to be the first car a lap down when the caution comes out. He just drives by Kyle Busch, but he is one lap down.
This is a fellow that has saved animals, helped out animal shelters. He has a foundation to help animals. They did a calendar. They did a book of drivers with their animals. You think just once he could be the lucky dog.
I was going to say, it looks like to me he needs one of his animals to throw something out on the racetrack real quick where he can get a caution. And how about Jeff Gordon in that 24 car? Just to update our viewers, back on lap 89, he cut a tire down under green. He got a caution, stayed on the lead lap, all the way at the tail of the field. Here he is. He just goes by his teammate Kyle Busch for the third position. Don't count this man out with 124 to go.
Oh, no. When the rest of them are hauling, they got brake troubles and other issues, his car will be in perfect condition.
Casey Kane dropped a cylinder. Got back on the lead lap with a free pass or two, and now you see a lot of smoke. It's not just one cylinder this time. It looks terminal for the Dodge dealer's number nine.
Most time you break a valve, or you know, you'll break a rocker arm or something in the valve train, and then it'll eventually just fall on down in there and punch a hole in a piston.
And remember, he has not had a finish out of the top 11. His worst finish, Daytona 11th, second in the points. That will definitely change today.
Tony Stewart controls the pace of this race, Darrell. If you're Jimmy Johnson, how hard do you want to push him with more than a... Oh, this hard for the lead.
I was just going to say, I won't buy, and I won't buy now.
I should have asked you a lap ago.
That 48 car has done exactly what I said they needed to do. They made that car better.
Now, Tony Stewart, the 20, he has already locked up the bonus points for leading the most lap. No one can catch him. He has led 261 laps. Here's Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the A car trying to fight his way back to the top 10.
He was alongside Kurt Busch a lap ago, and then things got dusted around to where Jamie McMurray has the advantage of Earnhardt and takes the spot away, so he loses one instead of gaining one.
Just not right ever since he hit that inside wall with that left front. They looked like they were getting it back there, but it's not quite what it was.
Yeah, it's not killed, obviously, but it's not as good as it was. Just that little bit of tap on the left front probably messed the toe up just enough, makes it a little more hard. It makes it harder to drive.
Too bad to contend with, too good to come in and try to fix it.
Yeah, you just gotta, as I always tell us, you got what you got.
Dick Bergeron.
With Casey Kane, what a shame you were running so well at the beginning of this event. The mechanics now have the valve covers off. What's wrong with this engine?
I think it must be a valve spring or something. It's unfortunate. These guys work really hard, and you know, our engines run great each week, so it's a tough break, but hopefully we can.
Big puff of smoke just came out of the engine. It does look terminal at this point, Mike.
Yeah, what he's talking about is on top of each valve, there's a spring. It's held in by a retainer. And this one of these little coils right here will break. And when it does, it lets the valve start to bounce up and down here and get into the top of the piston. And eventually, the piston will hit it hard enough that it'll break the top of the valve off.
And you actually have two springs per cylinder, or you have an inner and an outer, Jeff Hammond.
Yeah, guys, you can see right here, we're looking at the engine here. Here's the valve, as we see, going down into the piston area Daryl's talking about. This is the rocker arm. As it's going up and down, you can see if it does happen to break off and the piston comes up and would hit it, it'd get in here and rattle around, and eventually it would punch a hole in this piston.
And that's where the smoke comes from, Jeff. Once you punch a hole in the piston, starts sucking oil up out of the crankcase.
And you know, guys, even though we turned 9,400, 9,500 RPM here, this is normally not that hard on engine because it's just a spike in RPM. Next week at Texas, that's where it'll be hard on engine's hanging RPM.
What's the service life of a valve spring?
Hopefully 500 laps.
Well, one race and
yes,
you change them,
race.
Right?
Well, and sometimes there's some place where you'll change them that afternoon after practice and put a fresh set on for the race, depending on how bad, you know, what you feel like you've done to your engine.
Third place, teammates battle. Youngster Kyle Busch takes it to Jeff Gordon.
And one other thing, Mike, sometimes you can miss a shift, over-rev the engine and create that problem as well.
Just remember, it was not but about 8 or 10 laps ago that Jeff Gordon went by Kyle Busch in the 5. Now Kyle Busch takes the third position back away from his teammate with Elliott Sadler in the 38 closing.
110 laps to go in the DirecTV 500.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by Capital One. What's in your wallet? By DLP Picture Technology from Texas Instruments. By Coca-Cola, the official soft drink of NASCAR. And by Team Chevy and the 303 horsepower Monte Carlo SS. Chevy, an American revolution. Jimmy Johnson leads with 102 laps to go here in Martinsville. Tony Stewart, for the third straight race here in Southwest Virginia, has led the most laps. Kyle Busch running third, Jeff Gordon fourth. A quick recap. Lap 3, rookie Clint Bowyer. A number of cars in a pileup. Drivers were dizzy like Joanne Worley. Coming out of that, everybody's okay though. Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car is wrecked. Worked on, fell back to 42nd, but Junior worked his way all the way back up to 4th later in the race. Meanwhile, Jeff Burton and Kurt Busch at the top 10.
Yeah, Kurt gets in there, it was a little bit too hard, slides up, gets into the side of Jeff Burton, knocks him into the outside wall, and, you know, clearly Jeff Burton was really upset about that.
Kurt Busch is in the top 10, Jeff Burton all the way 70 laps down. Junior working his way back into the top 10. Ryan Newman was a lap down, but didn't leave him a lot of room, and that has affected the car further for Junior.
Yeah, short track racing at its finest, not his fault, but that's what happens here. Everybody gets together, beating and banging. Next thing you know, you're in the outside wall, inside wall.
Meanwhile, Jimmy Johnson and Tony Stewart have been dominating this race. As we said, Stewart leading the most laps, but with 120 to go, Jimmy Johnson taking the lead and trying to hold off Tony Stewart.
Tony Stewart right there on the inside, trying to make some gains and get back up on the back bumper of Jimmy Johnson. But Chris, it's time to go racing. Within 100 laps here, now it's when you need to get up on that wheel and show what you've been saving.
97 laps of Sakatumi time left at Martinsville, and it could be very interesting.
Very interesting, but not very funny.
This Elliott Sadler's coming, Larry.
We were talking about this battle right before we went to break. Remember, it wasn't that long ago, Jeff Gordon in the 24 was battling his teammate Kyle Busch in the 5 for third, but he's about to give up fourth to Elliott Sadler in the 38 car.
I think this is when, most of the time, this is when the crew chief really earns his money, in my opinion. He anticipated these track conditions. Hot temperature today, rubber buildup in the turns, shock package, spring package. This is when the really sharp guys take hold.
Sadler, fourth at Daytona. Best finish in his last four races was 13th last week at Bristol. He has one top five at Martinsville. Jimmy Johnson went powered himself back into the lead after that restart. We listen.
Been losing the lead like that. You guys get me on the lead, so I should go get it back.
He's doing a fine job at it.
Buddy, just settle in, settle in.
Well, at the top of the show, we talked about our FedEx racetrack keys right there. We've already talked about taking care of your brakes, but what Chad Knaus and Earl Barbin did right there, they covered both of these with Jimmy Johnson's patience for 500 laps and take care of your driver in more ways than one. Calm him down.
As Johnson works traffic, Stewart in the 20 has an opportunity to close back in. He has led the most laps here today, but only one Martinsville race in the last 8 was won by the driver who led the most laps, Ricky Craven in October 2001.
Now, we want to talk about the weather. Look how much the ambient temperature has come up right here. Now, the track temperature has not changed that much, but Darrell, you talked about it. I mean, this place is really getting slick. The cars are starting to slide around, and these guys are having to start move their car around with a lot of adjustments on their car.
A lot of these cars, Larry, you set them up to run a particular, you know, we set them up to run right against the curve, right around the bottom, and they just don't like it when you move up out of that groove and try to run a little higher. And that's another one of those things to me. It's just an anticipation thing. You got to anticipate. I got to be able to move to a different groove if I have to.
We saw Greg Biffle, who's had a tough day, 64 laps down from the National Guard Ford. He is in 32nd place. He spun to bring out the fourth caution of the day back on lap 110. Matt, what's Tony Stewart been saying on the radio about his 0.8 of a second lead?
Well, he's led 261 laps, Mike, and he says that they've made a lot of headway in one area. That's rolling through the center, but they still need help on exits. So the car is much better, but obviously, right now, the other car is much faster, meaning Jimmy Johnson.
Sure, visibly, don't see anything wrong with the car. It's just not as fast as he was earlier in the day. Things not sliding around a whole lot, and I don't see him sawing on the wheel a whole lot. Just looks like he's not running quite as quickly as, say, Jimmy Johnson is. Or as quickly as he was a little earlier. Just car looks good.
Third race in a row that Tony has led, third Martinsville race in a row, that he's led half the laps or more. Last spring, though, he finished 26th. Last fall, finished second.
Chris Myers talked about it earlier. Over 500 laps of the 1,000 laps he led here in 2005. And, Darrell, you know how hard this place is for a rookie. All these rookies, except for Denny Hamlin, never seeing the place. How about Reed Sorensen in the 41 car? Started in 25th, up there battling Kevin Harvick for the sixth position.
I've been watching him, Larry, and he's just done a fine job. He's been very aggressive. He hadn't just been riding around. He's raced hard, and he's closing up on the back of Kevin Harvick for another spot there. He's just had a whale of a good day. Good job for a young kid.
He's one of just two rookies on the lead lap. J.J. Yaley in 15th is the other.
But right behind Reed Sorensen, if he looks in the rearview mirrors, we've got a battle right here for second starting to kind of brew up right here. But back to Reed Sorensen. Matt Kenseth, another guy that's been quiet all day long, comes in here as our points leader. He's up there battling Reed in the top 10.
Well, remember, too, that yesterday in the final practice, Kenseth had a brake problem, broke a bracket off of his spindle that holds the caliper on. That was very fortunate for them, and here they are right now, sitting in pretty good shape. Jeff, how's it look down there where you are?
What I'm looking at right now, Darrell, is trying to figure out, Jimmy Johnson's got the lead, his car's looking really balanced, and you wonder what's going on with Tony Stewart. Has he lost a handle on the race car? What happens now, guys, if the caution does come out? Do you gamble and come on down pit road hoping everybody else follows you? Because if somebody stays out, track position is so important. We've seen that all day long. Does anybody come down pit road and try to, you know, make their car better for this final stretch? We're getting closer and closer to the end, and that becomes, I think, more of a serious discussion and a decision to be made.
Yeah, it's the same old thing, Jeff, that you see every week. Probably the first five or six, they're going to come to pit road. Somebody back there that's at the tail end maybe of the lead lap, they may gamble and stay out.
Yeah, we've got 17 cars in the lead lap. All the leaders were on pit road at lap 367 with 133 to go. Problem is, if you pit and you restart eighth with the lap down cars, it's like restarting 16th.
And we haven't seen that big a difference in new tires versus old tires. And don't forget, yesterday, that truck race, 11 truck, Toyota truck yesterday, David Starr won the race on a set of tires he run for about two-thirds of the race.
By the way, congratulations to his owner, our own Jeff Hammond.
Yeah, roger that.
Jimmy Johnson out in front of Tony Stewart by 0.8 of a second with 80 laps to go in the DirecTV 500.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by DirecTV, NASCAR, driven by DirecTV, by Enterprise Rent a Car, will we pick you up?
I'm gonna go
by Budweiser, the official beer of NASCAR.
We have restarted the DirecTV 500 with 67 laps to go. Audio difficulties with the transmission leaving Martinsville. We apologize. Hopefully everything is back. Okay. As Jimmy Johnson takes off from Tony Stewart on this restart, Kyle Busch now under fire by lap down Mark Martin. Now Sadler comes up alongside Martin as the first three cars have cleared the traffic.
Yeah, Mark, he'll be courteous to these guys. They're racing for the win. He just wants to stay first car one lap down if he can.
There was no free pass on the 13th caution of the day. Ryan Newman had been waiting to get one. He would have been the free pass car, but he was also the cause of the caution. A tire went down on Newman's car.
And because they felt like he intentionally brought the caution out, they held him an additional lap. So right now, Ryan Newman is in 23rd, three laps down.
Let's get an update on pit road activity to Kurtgren.
Well, Jimmy Johnson's crew is concerned that that pit stop was going to be troublesome because the 12 car of Ryan Newman was parked directly in front of him. But Johnson did a great job bringing the car in. They had to drive around some of the crew members, and he left pit road first. Matty.
Tony Stewart about a car length and a half to two car lengths back of the 48, Jimmy Johnson. Now, he said, I need help most on the forward bite, meaning his exit of the corner. So they made half the adjustment they made on the previous stop. Stewart says hopefully that's what we'll need to put this car into victory lane this year. Jeannie?
Well, the five of Kyle Busch saying, I need some bite, but they're trying to think ahead of themselves here, realizing that there will probably be another caution, so they didn't want to overcorrect the problem too much, just some air pressure adjustments for the five.
Fourth place, Elliott Sadler, the 38. That's the first Ford in the race, the M&M's car. The leading Dodge is Kurt Busch in the 2 and 8th place.
Larry, if my car is very good right now, I don't plan on making any more pit stops.
I was going to say, we may have more cautions, but these guys pitting with about 75 laps to go, not sure you'll be back on pit road.
Jeff Gordon has won here three times in the spring and four times in the fall. And behind him, Matt Kenseth, who came in here with a point standing lead, running in sixth, 4 seconds off the leader. He's got Kevin Harvick and Kurt Busch to worry about, seventh and eighth place.
Yeah, Kurt's made his car a lot better on this last round of pit stops. He hadn't been able to keep up with Harvick the last couple of restarts, but right now he's there.
And then right behind this group, we were talking about him earlier, Reed Sorensen in the 41 car, the rookie, gave up about three positions by virtue of that last pit stop, but still solidly in the top 10, as well as Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car, who has had a very eventful day. He's back in the top 10.
Junior's old car. Right front fender torn off of it, left front fender all banged in, but he's doing a good job of hanging in there today.
You know, when his dad first came here in the late model sportsman ranks that became the Busch Series, that's about how Dale's car would look at the end of the race.
Yeah.
At that time, the bodies were the same between the Chevy Nova, the Pontiac Ventura, the Buick Apollo, and the old Zomega. And by the end of a 250-lap race here, you couldn't tell which one of those four Dale had brought to the racetrack because there wasn't enough front sheet metal left on it to tell.
No, he had parts from all of them on his car when the day was over with.
Some of them his.
Some of them his, some of them somebody else's.
Right now, our two leaders, Jimmy Johnson in the 48, Tony Stewart in the 20, on a stopwatch is pretty equal. There you see his crew chief, Chad Knaus. So we've got the battle right here. This is a battle for six between Matt Kenseth in that yellow 17, Kevin Harvick in the 29. I think there's no question Harvick's car much better here, he should complete the pass before they get down the backstretch.
Yeah, Matt got loose off the four, and that kind of opened the door for Kevin to go by. Now here's Kurt Busch looking to the outside. Junior looking at him.
I like what Harvick did there, Darrell. He gave Kenseth a little tap, gave him a little bump, but not a dump. He said, hey, I'm here, I'm coming. Kenseth moved over, let him go through.
Now what Matt Kenseth is doing right now, his car's not what it should be, but he's trying his best to keep the bottom, hold the bottom of the racetrack, knows if they've got to go by him, they're going to have to do it on the high side if he can possibly do it.
95
trouble turn three.
Yeah, he's up in the middle of the race. He's got a tire down. He can't get out of the way.
And it's a long way back to the entrance of pit road. We're still green right now.
No caution for Stanton Barrett. And he's got a fire underneath the right front as well.
He's got a broken suspension.
Yep.
It's not his tire. You can see that wheel juking back and forth in there. He's broken something.
Now we have a caution on the speedway.
Something wrong with that right front. It's not a flat tire, suspension or something.
Like you said.
Yeah. Suspension.
Now it took Mark Martin about 300 laps, but he finally gets the free pass. Mark Martin in the six car will be back on the lead lap. Now I think we can safely say, Darrell and I were talking about it a while ago, about 16 laps since we restarted a while ago, fresh tires on everybody. I think you'll see everybody stay out here with 52 laps to go.
I like the view from the front.
18 cars on the lead lap.
Get out no matter what. I don't care what.
Stanton Barrett, there's the 95 trying to get down and out of harm's way, but when the right front suspension is broken, it just doesn't steer.
Actually did a really good job of not wrecking anybody because had very little control over the car.
Carrying the autism awareness camera.
He knows he's got a problem trying to get to pit road going too fast.
Looks like he's got a right front down or something. 95, he's checking up. Easy, he's right in the middle now. Keep coming, no caution yet, no caution. Clear low.
Some of the lead lap cars are pitting. Here comes Brian Vickers, Carl Edwards, Jamie McMurray, Sterling Marlin, and Scott Riggs to pit road.
Well, you mentioned we've got 18 cars on the lead lap now, one of those being Mark Martin. It was basically everyone but Jeremy Mayfield that was at the back of those lead lap cars.
Makes sense.
Why not?
Still 50 laps to go in the DirecTV 500. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
The DirecTV 500 on Fox is sponsored by DirecTV. NASCAR driven by DirecTV. By Enterprise Rent-A-Car, we'll pick you up. By Budweiser, the official beer of NASCAR. This is Budweiser. This is beer. And by Sprint, proud partner of the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series. Nextel FanView, a way for fans at every track to get more information on their favorite driver, whether it's audio, statistical information. To learn more, go to foxsports.com/NextelFanView. And you can get more information like the points up to the moment, and Jimmy Johnson would recapture the points lead ahead of Matt Kenseth. We still have 47 laps to go. Chevy in the top three spots, Jimmy Johnson, Tony Stewart, and Kyle Busch. Mike?
18 cars on the lead lap. Jimmy Johnson in 2006, two wins, a second, a sixth, and 30th at Bristol. Tony Stewart right on his tail in what may be the final restart of the day, green flag.
That inside line really started stacking up there behind Dave Blaney. All of our lead lap cars doing their best to try to clear that lap down traffic. Well, they go out there and get after it. Darrell, this is where you better reach prayer, as I tell you at the beginning of the race, and pull those belts tight one more time. It's going to get exciting.
45 laps to go. Been taking care of your stuff. Got a little bit left. Time to use it.
Dick Bergman.
Generally speaking, Chad Knauss' decisions are made quickly and they're made with great confidence. Such was not the case on that caution flag. Knauss, remember, 2004, where he urged his driver to stay out toward the end of the race. Others pitted, took fresh tires, and Johnson lost the race, finishing in fourth spot. Knauss asked Jimmy Johnson, what do we do here? Pit,
Do we stay out? Remember what happened to us 2 years ago. Nothing was said. The driver made the decision, and it was apparently the right one. Virtually everybody stayed out with him this time.
But Dick, Darrell, Mike, I think the difference, as you mentioned earlier, Darrell, we've got a harder tire here. It doesn't give up that much on the stopwatch as much as the tire did back in 2004.
Dave Blaney having trouble getting out of the way of cars in the back straightaway. Three wide into the corner. Junior way on the inside. He gets out of the gas and everybody's okay. My goodness.
I'm going to tell you what. This last time through three and four, Jimmy Johnson in the 48 just stopped in the middle of turn three and four. Tony Stewart almost turned under him. Finally, Johnson got it back going. Tell you what, 42 laps to go. It's shaping up here.
Jimmy's a little bit better than Tony, but not very much.
Here's what got our attention in the back straightaway 2 laps ago.
All these cars are battling for position.
That's where it got three wide going into the corner and sorted out.
Checking up, keep coming. Three wide.
Yeah, three wide will not work. It's pretty treacherous, two wide.
Well, credit due to Dale Jr. because on that one, 12 wheels would have cornered better than four. If he'd stayed in there, the outside car, which was Kurt Busch, would have paid the price.
Junior, it's like driving a modified, you know, where the tire doesn't sticks out over there. You got to take care of that right front tire.
This is a battle for the seventh position right now. Elliott Sadler in the 38 car looks like he just kind of rattled the cage on the 5 car. Kyle Busch, he takes the third position away.
I think the 19's got an engine problem.
Elliott Sadler and Kyle Busch.
Just ever so slightly in the left rear.
Not too politely. Meanwhile, Jeremy Mayfield, big trouble.
Yeah, he just went up in a plume of smoke.
Now remember, if this indeed, and we don't know that it's an engine problem, remember his teammate Casey Kane had an engine problem earlier. That possibly could be some of the other troubles we've seen, gear or transmission.
Pretty terminal.
Whatever it is. And Jeremy had a great run going, but as you said, with 160 to go, we got a long way to go.
Yes, sir. You got to be up there at the end. And the thing I like about our leader is Jimmy Johnson's not driving as hard as Tony Stewart is. Tony is charging down in the corner. Jimmy's easing down the corner, and he's beating Tony off. That's what you want here. Take care of that thing getting off. You'll be fine.
And Jimmy can do that right now. Problem's going to be with 35 to go. They will start catching some lap cars.
And here comes one of the masters of Martinsville, Jeff Gordon. 7 wins here, powering past Kyle Busch to move up into 4th.
I love it. Win. You say, where'd he come from?
Well, we've got to pick an All-State good hands driver of the day. And through all the incidents, Dale Earnhardt Jr. still contending in 7th place right now. You saw him as part of the
2-car in the wall.
Yep. Junior fought his way back after being involved in the first incident of the day, and even after a bump from Ryan Newman sent him into the inside wall. 3 of the 4 corners of that car are bent up or broken, but Junior is still in the top 10. On behalf of Dale Jr., Allstate will donate a $1,000 scholarship to the Urban Youth Racing School, Allstate official insurance partner of NASCAR.
All I know is with 32 laps to go, we got them 3 and 4 wide down the back straightaway right now.
Marlin almost got turned by Jeff Green, and those two I was watching because earlier it was Jeff Green on the receiving end from Sterling Marlin.
That might not be over with just yet.
But this is where the spotter and the crew chief, Sterling Marlin, settled him down. He's still on the lead lap. Could have a good finish here. Don't let your emotions run away with you on a car that's several laps down.
Leaders, Stewart to the inside.
48 car got that good bite on the high side.
Good job.
Little bump. Bigger bump. Johnson on the brakes. Brake job.
inside.
Whoa!
Inside, inside, inside.
He gives Stewart room this time.
But this is where Johnson gets that good run again off turn two. But where his weaker is three and four.
Tell you what, he's aggravating the heck out of him with all the bumping that's going on.
Tell you who loves this, Elliott Sadler. Here comes the Candyman right up on the leaders.
Well, and so does Jeff Gordon, who's right here just lurking back there too. But Tony is really using Jimmy up right now.
But Darrell, it looks like Johnson in the 48, he's moved up to the high side and in the lane two, both ends of the racetrack where there's good fight right now.
He got knocked up there, Larry. I don't think he moved up there. He got moved to the top.
And his spotter
inside
sent him up
inside.
There.
20 car only.
Little rub.
Full car in front on
and
the top.
Trouble for Yaley. Flat tire, left front. No caution.
But why those two guys been going at it? We talked about it. Elliott Sadler in the 38 car right there in the mix with him.
Jimmy gave Tony a shot. Tony might have been a little late on the gas there. You never know. Hard to tell, Darrell. Does one car run into another, or does the lead car hit the brake, or does it even matter?
You figure it out. If the guy that was behind you is beating your back bumper off, he gets in front of you, what are you going to do?
And look at Jeff Gordon in the 24 car. We got all top four right there together. 26 to go.
I love this place.
Doesn't get any better than this, folks.
And Kyle Busch is sitting back there going, you know, if they all get together, I win.
Things have settled down a little bit now. They've spaced themselves out a little. I think Jimmy just kind of, Tony got him frustrated. Jimmy took it out on him a tad, but Tony's driving off now.
There goes Elliott Sadler up the racetrack. Jeff Gordon in the 24 gets by, and Sadler's got a problem.
All clear.
Does he have a problem, or did he get hit?
I don't think anybody touched him, Darrell.
But if he got that high up the racetrack, you talked about it earlier, he gets all that rubber on his tires, and he can't turn the race car.
He's going down into turn one here. Jeff Gordon looks to the inside. Jeff looked to the inside. I think it distracted Elliott just enough.
Darrell, I'm not too sure. Maybe he will hop a little bit right there, because a lot of times during the course of the race, remember, you take the brake adjuster and you get a little bit out of balance, drive in a little hard, we'll hop a little bit and do the same thing.
Yeah, I think what happened to Jeff is Jeff Gordon looked underneath of him and Elliott looked back to see where he was, and he lost his focus for a second and got loose getting in.
Now, a lap ago, Jimmy Johnson took it deep into turn three, right to Tony Stewart's bumper. You see him close again right here, going into the corner.
This battle isn't over. I mean, I'm pretty sure if Jimmy can get back to him, there'll be some more bumping and grinding there.
And the problem, we've been talking about it, 22 to go, they're going to catch several lap cars here in just a few laps.
It's funny how before the 48 car was getting off the corner better than the 20, now the 20's getting off the corner better than the 48.
Dale Jr. completes the pass of Sadler. That's fifth place.
And I believe when the 24 gets up there, the 48 might just be in trouble, and he might have to let him go and let him go work on the 20.
Mark Martin passed Carl Edwards. That's 14th place.
Remember, these cars all have fairly fresher tires because they pitted on that last car.
I tell you what, though, I am impressed with Jeff Gordon. Not that I never ever am, but here he is. He's up here. He's got a shot at winning this race. And where's he been all day? Just kind of working himself methodically back into that position.
Running his race.
And now he has caught his Hendrick Motorsports teammate.
The other thing I like, he's got a little bit different line, particularly in three and four. He's really good on the outside. That could pay off.
He's even entering the corner a little higher, especially, as you said, down in turn three.
Yeah, one and two around the bottom. Three and four got a little high arc down here that's working for him. He's going to get by Jimmy Johnson. Watch this. Outside. Gets a look underneath.
Whoa! Jimmy Johnson got bad loose. He will complete the pass. 17 to go.
And if I was Tony Stewart, I'd be saying, roll, roll.
Let's roll. Let's get a good finish.
The differential is 1 second with 17 laps to go. Tony Stewart and Jeff Gordon.
And that voice you heard a while ago, Earl Barbin, Jimmy Johnson's spotter, saying, look, third place is still not a bad day here.
The last four races in which Tony Stewart led the most laps, he did not go to victory lane. That includes last week at Bristol. Maybe things will turn around today.
If he gets held up, if he gets held up here very long and Jeff can get to him, Jeff's better.
15 to go.
Jimmy Johnson has slid back to third. What about it, Dick?
He just came on the radio, Mike, and said that he had lost rear grip in the car. Chad Knaus said he knew that. Just get a good finish out of it.
That's turn two.
That's going to do. Trouble in turn two.
Joe Nemechek has pounded the wall. And that is caution flag 15.
15 laps ago? I don't think so.
Yeah, I don't have any brakes. They went to the floor.
But I'm going to tell you who likes this caution. Jeff Gordon in that 24 car.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, this business is getting ready to pick up, baby.
Yes, sir.
And I tell you, Jimmy Johnson get a chance to cool those rear tires off. He might be a factor again, too. Looked like he was pretty good on restarts.
That road's open. Will anybody come?
I think you're going to see the same thing we've seen. The guys at the back of the lead lap cars, yeah, they'll probably come to pit road because we're going to be right there at 10 or less laps to go on this restart.
Watch the 01 up high.
Just gets in there on a little too high. When you get in high, it's a little dirty out there. You get that on the rear tires and around you go.
That's pretty hard hit. Well, let's try this one more time with where the caution flags have come out today. One over here, one over here, one over here, one over here, 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 here. Bam, 15 caution flags.
Looked like to me 3 and 4 has been the real problem, child.
Yep.
What's the record? About 16.
Start
isn't it?
Finish line still looks pretty good.
Hey, Slob, what's the record for cautions here?
19. That's Bill Svoboda. He's our statistician.
Sorry, that's our statistician over there.
Now, you're seeing some of the cars that now are one or more laps down go to pit road. Cars on the lead lap that pitted, Reed Sorensen, Kurt Busch, Carl Edwards, Mark Martin, and Sterling Marlin.
And Carl Edwards going to have trouble beating the pace car. I think he will. So, Visa race break. Here's Chris.
Thanks, Mike, from the Hollywood Hotel with Jeff Hammond observing this race. And Jeff Gordon, who at one time was 26, we know that he's won here 7 times, swept the races last year, is driving a heck of a race.
Oh, I'm telling you right now, he's driving like a man possessed. I mean, he really has made his way up through traffic, drove smart, car still clean. And right now, after what happened to him last week, he is definitely hungry.
So what should we look for in this restart?
Anything and everything. You mean we've already seen the pushing, bumping, and shoving from the 48 and the 20. I expect the same thing from the 24 and the 20 once we go back to green. And don't forget, the 48 is kind of lurking right back there behind both of them.
Obviously, the experience of Jeff Gordon here and Tony Stewart, who has won more races in the state of Virginia than in any other state in his career. This has been a Visa race break. No matter what it takes, life takes Visa. Mike?
Well, Tony Stewart has one Martinsville victory, and he has the grill pushed in here. But he is the fourth driver to lead the most laps in 3 straight Martinsville races, joining Cale Yarborough, Dale Earnhardt, and Rusty Wallace in that exclusive category. But can he seal the deal?
Yeah, that looks like it'd be ducking more air into the radiator way. It's folded down right there where the opening is. And plus the bottom down there, all this down in here is open as well on his car, just like it is on Jeff Gordon.
They look a mirror of each other, the 24 and the 20. Now, here's also good news for Jeff Gordon. Remember, when we get to 10 or less laps to go, it's a single-file restart. So Jeff Gordon will not have to contend with lap-down cars on the inside. So that's good news. More good news for Jeff Gordon.
Let me ask you something, Larry. You think there'll be any contact in this last little bit of the race?
I would say probably so.
I
would say during the race, maybe after the race.
Yeah, that too.
They've waved off one to go. And it will be a single file restart. And I believe they waved it off because that will take a little time to get the field into the proper order with just the lead lap cars in front.
I tell you, another guy that's sitting back here, I think he's going to make a little move on some guys, is that 8 car. He was coming on the 5, but when that caution came out, he gotten by the 38 at Elliott Sadler and was closing on the 5.
And I tell you, something else that has changed. We've been following the track temperature, the conditions. It has really started to get a little bit overcast here. Track really cooling down. That could be good news for Jimmy Johnson. He's cooled those rear tires down.
I think it helped Tony Stewart, too, because where he was complaining about being a little bit loose up off the corner, looked like it helped him.
Tonight on Fox, primetime beginning at 7 with Malcolm in the Middle, followed by King of the Hill, The Simpsons, The Loop, Family Guy, and Free Ride. That's all coming up later this evening on Fox.
this here is what it's all about. Half mile short track, about 80, 90,000 people. Nobody's sitting down.
It's what we always call the trophy dash.
This is it.
And here the trophy is that beautiful Ridgeway grandfather clock.
Yeah, baby.
Tony Stewart has one. He wants another.
And she's about to strike 12.
Eight laps
to go. Green flag.
Stewart got a real good restart. Jeff Gordon, watch him drive it off into turn one here.
Kind of like where Jeff was. He laid back a
trouble.
Chad Kenseth hard in the outside wall.
Oh, my gosh.
Caution will be out.
I can't believe he can drive that car away. It's a safer barrier, but he hit it hard.
And remember, he came in here our points leader, so that's the top two in points, Matt Kenseth, Casey Kane.
Yeah, he was running in eighth place.
Both having major problems here today.
Let's see what happens to him here. Oh, gosh, he's sideways on the straightaway.
Yeah, something big
broke.
Time. There's something big time in trouble.
I bet it broke an axle or something. Because it turned sideways like that?
Way back on the straightaway.
Something definitely.
The good news is safer barrier.
You know, I had an issue yesterday in practice with a broken brake bracket. I don't think that was a brake problem. It happened on the straightaway where I don't think you'd be using the brakes. Almost looked like something broke in the drivetrain, maybe like an axle.
Now the impact punched a hole in the radiator oil cooler and gosh knows what else. So you see that snail's trail behind Kenseth, and it goes all the way back to the impact spot on the wall. They are going to halt the cars at turn four to clean that up so we can get back to green.
Look at the crew members on the 17th.
They ask you permission.
Okay? Is it okay if we push it?
And the reason they're doing that, in that practice yesterday, Matt Kenseth had the problem in turn one and two, was stopped up against the outside wall. Two of his crew members went out there to see what the problem was. The next shot we saw, they were being escorted to the NASCAR trailer, so they definitely got permission. May we?
Is it okay?
Can we?
They may need the tow truck to move that car any further. And so it's a little bit longer wait for Steve Letarte, Chad Knaus, Greg Zipidelli, the crew chiefs on the three leading cars. As we are red flagged at Martinsville with seven laps to go. The suspense just keeps on building in the DirecTV 500. Skies in Martinsville, Virginia, but Matt Kenseth's sunny day ended eight laps short of the finish. Matt Yocum's with him.
Matt getting ready to walk into the infield care center. Matt, what happened?
We just lost our brakes, I guess. The pedal was soft, but I had a little bit of brake, and we went for that restart, and I got out of the gas at the finish line. I was just going to pull down low and let everybody go, and I hit the brakes a little bit, and just locked the rear tires up and spun out.
Good news is he's okay. He's going to go in for a checkup, though. NASCAR regulations.
Hard hit. And that car made it back around to pit road but wouldn't steer its way into the garage. And they're going to sweep up the fluid dropped by Kenseth's car so we can get this race back under green.
Well, we have two master cylinders, one for the front, one for the rear. Probably when he hit the pedal, it locked the rears up. And that's why I think I heard Hammond ask me if I heard the wheel hop. Something must have happened there.
But you know, Darrell, Jeff and I were talking about it earlier. You know, for so many years you come here and you almost would know that half the field was probably going to have brake problems. And the brake companies stepped up to the plate, a little better, but I almost question now, with the speeds they're running, the amount of brake they have, the drivers using so much, that it's just, the law of physics are taking over with these brake packages.
Well, you know, drivers, you know how they are. The more you give us, the more we'll use. So even though they're better, we just use them more.
That's it.
We still have seven laps to race here in Martinsville. There's the leading crew chief right now, Greg Zipidelli. But next week we go to Texas. Chris Myers.
And just a reminder, next weekend NASCAR moving to Texas. Our coverage beginning on Friday with Cup qualifying, followed by the IROC race on speed. Saturday, Nextel Cup practice on FX, followed by Busch Series Racing and the O'Reilly 300 presented by AOL. That's on Fox. And next Sunday, NASCAR Race Day on Speed, and then Nextel Cup Racing with the Samsung Radio Shack 500. That's on Fox. And Greg Biffle won the race last year. They'll hit speeds of 200 miles per hour. Hang on to your RPM. Here it's a little different. Blue skies, red flags, seven laps to go. Tony Stewart ahead of Jeff Gordon. We're talking about as they, Jeff Hammond, put the Speedy Dry down and clear the track, it may change the conditions of this track for the finish of this race.
Yeah, that's one thing you got to be kind of worried about is whether or not how much fluid got on the racetrack, where it got on the racetrack at, and whether or not, you know, some of these leaders will have to run through it. But we're using the jet dryer, blow dryer, to kind of go around the racetrack and blow all this off again could affect how the racetrack feels of the leader. So for Tony Stewart, I'm sure he's going to be checking it out, trying to make sure where he wants to run is good and clean, and hopefully it won't affect him.
All right, Tony Stewart, your leader. Let's check in with Greg Zipadelli, his crew chief, standing by with Matt Yoka. Matt?
Well, their pit box is more like a condo. You've got Mr. Nardelli from Home Depot up here, half a dozen crew guys, Jimmy Makar behind me, the team manager. And Zippy, you've been in this situation before. He had a great restart the last time.
Yeah, we need to get that. We'll probably have about five to go. We'll keep our fingers crossed. I hear the 48 and the 24 kind of conversing back and forth about having no mercy. So I'm sure after what happened at 24 last week and what he went through, we've seen a good restart, get a good run up off the corner, and hopefully we can hold him off for five, six laps.
Hoping to get another grandfather clock here at Martinsville. Mike?
Well, that would be two for Tony Stewart, and it would be the third for Joe Gibbs Racing. Bobby Labonte also won a race here for Joe. We know what Tony Stewart will do, but if you're Jeff Gordon, Darrell, and you want to win this race, what do you do?
I'd lay back just a little on the restart. I'd get me a good run, and if I'm going to move him, it's going to be in turn one early. I'm not going to wait till the last lap.
Larry, how do you help him time that restart?
Well, that's all. Jeff Gordon, nobody knows any better than Jeff Gordon with his experience, but I think Darrell's right. If he's going to get him, he's got to do it early, and then he better get out of Dodge in a hurry.
So, Jeff Hammond, how do you get your driver keyed up when he's got to get out there for seven laps? He's got to try to win this thing.
Well, I think the first thing you got to do, if you're Greg Zipadelli, you got to make sure Tony gets those tires cleaned off, Mike, because that could be the kiss of death right there. You spin those tires on a restart, and Jeff Gordon's going to jump inside of you on a heartbeat. The same way with the rest of the guys who want to attack Tony. They've got to get their tires cleaned off, be ready, and anticipate. I mean, anticipation is going to be probably the key here right now, Chris. If you want to get a good restart, all of these guys will be sitting there right now kind of like running this thing through their minds. And as far as the crew chief's concerned, it's kind of like sitting on needles and pins.
You said at the beginning of the day the buzzword was cool. And so far, the drivers, their tempers have been cool. Obviously, brakes are running hot with some problems there. But Jeff Gordon told us on the pre-race show, when we asked him if he would react the same way after last week's race in Bristol with Matt Kenseth, and he said he would. I mean, that's how heated he was. He's talked about being a more aggressive driver, no more Mr. Nice Guy. That's the way people are racing. How aggressive can he be, will he be, with Tony Stewart in front of him?
Well, he made it pretty clear to us as we take a look at Dale Jr. He's putting his gloves back on, getting ready for these final few laps. But he made it clear to us in another interview early on this week that he was hungry. And he wants to win. We already know he knows how to win here. He won both races here a year ago. He'd love to come back and make it three in a row. So if I was Tony Stewart, I would be a little bit anxious thinking, well, I don't know what he might do right at this moment, because we've seen him get roughed up at Bristol, and he might be thinking, man, I got to win this race, but I've got to get his back bumper and kind of upset him a little bit. So it's going to be real interesting. A little mind game going on right now sitting there while we got this red flag.
Darrell, NASCAR has shown pretty consistently that they will not enforce a penalty against the bump and run. Now, the bump and dump, you turn somebody around, that might be a different story, but if you just ease somebody out of the way, NASCAR's pretty much said that's accepted on-track behavior. So how far do you dare push the envelope or push the bumper?
Well, here's the thing you got to think about. We have stay dry all in the first turn. If I could get to Tony just ever so slightly and get him up the hill ever so slightly, he gets in that stay dry, I haven't really done anything except put him in a bad position. But what Tony has to be sure of is don't underestimate your competition. Anticipate that's going to happen and be darn sure that you get to first turn with a little comfort between you and the guy behind you.
Well, let's go to Matt in the pit of the second place car.
Well, Steve Letart talking to his driver on the radio. What an impressive run your driver's had coming back from that flat tire on lap 89.
Yeah, I would like to think we had a car good enough to run second, but it's been all Jeff Gordon today. The car's been a little off, and here in the last 50 laps, he's impressed us all.
A win today would be very special for the entire Hendrick family and organization. It would have been Ricky Hendrick's 26th birthday.
Yeah, we're really pulling for Mr. Hendrick. You know, he's the leader of our ship. He's why we're here, and we really want to win this one for him.
You can see it on his face. You can hear it on the radio. These guys really want to go to victory lane, especially today.
And you can hear the guys down there, Larry. They're burning those rear tires off, getting all that debris off of there. They've been setting. They cooled a little bit. Get some heat in them. You've got to be up on the chip right here coming to get the green.
Now, not too many laps ago, Jeff Gordon passed his Hendrick teammate, Jimmy Johnson. Johnson sits in third. What's his role in all this?
Well, I think right now he just doesn't want to mess up Jeff Gordon. I think, you know, not only is he sitting in third, but you got Kyle Busch sitting here in fourth. So you got all three Hendrick cars right there together. I know what Mr. Hendrick is. And then, so they're all focuses on one thing. Get by that 20 car.
And remember, Jimmy Johnson lost the points lead at Bristol to Matt Kenseth and Casey Kane. Both those cars in the garage area, big picture racing too.
All right, then let me throw a wild card at you. The number 8. Dale Jr.'s knocked 3 out of 4 corners off that car today. He had a lot of help doing it, but he's still a top 5 car. He's still a contender.
Yeah, I think he's pretty happy that he's been able to recover and end up where he is. If that's where he ends up at the end of the day, I think he says, I did the best I could do with what I had to work with.
Wild card number 2, the kid in 4th place right now. You know what he wants. He wants to win races. Kyle Busch.
But he can't. There's no way that Jimmy Johnson can mess up Jeff Gordon. But Kyle Busch cannot do anything but mess up Jimmy Johnson.
Exactly. Right.
And he's going to come out of here with a point lead. Somebody's reminding him of that, I'm sure.
So it sounds like the real key to the last few laps is whether or not Tony Stewart can keep Jeff Gordon away from his rear bumper.
Oh, I think that's the whole thing. If I'm Jeff, I'm going to try to time this restart where I'm on Tony Stewart's bumper when I get to turn one. And I mean on it.
And you mentioned Kyle Busch, you know, sitting 5th in the points. He can come out of here as long as he can have a top 5 right up there in the thick of this points deal too.
There's not enough laps to do anything dumb. I mean, you don't want to go down here, Kyle Busch doesn't, and get into the back of Jimmy Johnson, mess them both up, and they end up 10th, 12th, 15th. So those guys are kind of they got to play the hand they've been dealt. That 20 car and that 24 car, it's a whole different deal right there.
Behind the racetrack, the street that leads to the parking lots is vacant. Nobody has left Martinsville Speedway. Jimmy Johnson's team said this.
All right, bud. They told the 20 to watch his restart, and they want y'all to drive like professionals. No rooting and gouging.
And you heard Jimmy acknowledge that, right?
Right.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Right. Pace cars in. Buckle up, folks. It's going to be 3 laps to go.
Should be good. Jeff right up on him. He's not going to let him get away. Whoa, he got away a little bit.
He did. He spun his tire just ever so slightly, but so did Jeff Gordon in the 24. Kyle Busch in the 5 took a look to the inside of the 48. There goes Dale Earnhardt Jr. on the outside.
Well, Jeff Gordon got in the stage draw off of 2 over there. That's where the bad stuff was. Really cost him a lot of time.
Yeah, it could be over. Gordon got loose out of 2, and he's holding everybody up.
Now, Kyle Busch got a good run on the top side off turn 4.
What Kyle Busch is going to have to watch is from the stage drive down there on the outside of turn 2. Watch that stage drive.
While this is going on, though, Tony Stewart in the 20, he's drove off into the sunset. White flag this time.
Can you say adios, amigos?
Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car, he's going to make this a 3-way battle for 3rd.
Kyle Busch slips up. Here comes Johnson.
Yeah, the stage drive's real bad down there, right in the middle of 1 and 2 and off. Kyle got on the outside a little bit too much.
And here comes Jr. to the inside.
Big orange, Tony Stewart gets the win.
And Kyle Busch got loose. Dale Earnhardt Jr. will beat him back to the line for 4.
Well, it was a good race for 2nd, 3rd, and 4th.
It was that.
High fives all around. As Tony Stewart, who had not won since Watkins Glen last August, earns his 25th career Nextel Cup victory. Back, you're watching NASCAR on Fox.
Fun post race.
Welcome to the Sprint post-race show from Martinsville, Virginia. Nice to have you with us for NASCAR on Fox. And the Chevy winning moment. Chevy congratulates Tony Stewart and the 20 Home Depot car, his Monte Carlo SS. Another great Team Chevy victory. 25 of the last 34 NASCAR Manufacturers Championships and counting. Chevy, an American revolution. Tony Stewart, who called the grandfather clock one of the coolest trophies around, has added that to his collection, his second, and Dick Burgert is down there with him.
Yeah, Tony Stewart just told me that he has not felt well all weekend, just didn't tell anybody about it. You talked about the importance of patience and attitude before the running of this event. How key were those things today for you?
Real good. I mean, the last three races, I think we've led the most laps here, so we've obviously had an awesome car. We're just, being able to hold that 24 car off is what really has made me happy today, because Jeff's so good here, and especially late in a race like that. I mean, even when I saw him back and forth, I thought he's holding something back. But, this is Ricky Hendrick's birthday today, and I know I'm not part of the Hendrick organization, but every time we come to Martinsville, we think of the Hendrick family and the tragedy and Scott Latham and his family, and just want to let everybody know we're thinking about them. And just what an awesome way to get this first one done.
Incredible. Great job, Tony Stewart. Let's go to Matt.
What an impressive run by Jeff Gordon, bouncing back from that cut tire. Did the last caution hurt you? Did you get in some oil dry or something, Jeff?
Man, I don't know. I did everything I could to really get some heat and scrub the tires good. And the caution before that, the restart, my car just took off, and I was like, oh, man, we got something for him now. And, I knew if I could get my nose in there that things were going to get interesting. But what an incredible effort by this DuPont Chevrolet team, Steve and all the guys. We had I overheated the right front with the brakes, and I had to calm down from there and take it a little bit easier. And we weren't the best car today. We had to work on the handling, and we got a lot better there at the end. So I was just happy to be up there battling in the top five. And I think if I could have gotten a fender underneath them, things could have got interesting. But I didn't have enough for Tony there on that last restart.
Great run by Jeff Gordon, the driver. Also great run by Jeff Gordon, the car owner. The 48 finishes third. Jimmy's standing by with Jeannie.
Yeah, Jimmy is standing right by. Just hearing from Jeff talking about he didn't have as much car left to really catch Tony. Was the same situation for you? Were you sliding back?
Yeah, I was sliding all over the place. The guys gave me a great race car, great pit stops, and just kind of ran out of stuff there late. And Tony's always really good here on the short runs, so kind of lost a little ground to him, and the 24 got by, and we brought home a nice third place finish.
A good finish for your team in general. Thanks for the time.
Thank you.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., your car looked more like an old NASCAR coupe modified there, the way the thing was all beaten and banged. What a good run.
Yeah, I kind of looked like Harry Gant out there for a while. He was when he won out here with that fender missing. Beating and banging, man. I was worried my car was tore up too bad to be competitive, but I want to thank my team for working hard and getting me back out on the racetrack without getting me a lap down, making everything, cutting everything away that needed to be out of the way. The car still drove great, and they worked on it and didn't give up, and just real proud of the effort they gave me today. It's just such a pleasure to drive that car when those guys work as hard as they do. I want to thank everybody back at DEI for their efforts. This program, this company is turning around. Martin had a little tough day, but I ran over everything my first time at Martinsville, so it takes a while. He'll come around, but just proud of my team. I want to thank Budweiser and all our sponsors. It was just a great day for us. Even though we didn't win, we really felt like it.
Fourth here in Martinsville. Chris?
All right, and Dale Earnhardt Jr., sixth. So he jumps quite a bit. Jeff Hammond, Jimmy Johnson reclaims the points lead heading to Texas, but Mark Martin second.
Yeah, he's not even supposed to be racing here this year. I mean, he was supposed to be retired. Here he is. He finds himself second in the points, and this might just fire him up. We may have one whale of a point battle. You take a look at Matt Kenseth. He dropped the third, but I'm really impressed with what Mark's doing.
Tony Stewart winding up eighth or moving up to eighth. Dale Jarrett, who led a lap today. Kevin Harvick, who hung around for a little while. Kurt Busch as well, rounding out the top 20. And Martin Truex Jr., you heard Dale Earnhardt Jr. referring to him. It was the hottest race of the season. There's a look at the winning trophy, the grandfather clock. I hope they set that forward 1 hour. Tony Stewart already set everything forward by leading the most laps. We want to send a special get well out to Steve Burns, part of our pit crew, recovering from a sinus infection. He'll be back with us next week, and hope that you'll be watching from Texas as well. Don't forget on CMI on Fox Sports Net tonight at 10:30 Eastern, Jeff Gordon. Conversation with him about his career at this point. So hottest race of the season. Drivers kept their cool. Tony Stewart leading the most laps. Jimmy Johnson right behind him. Terrific runs by Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Jeff Gordon concerning where they were in the race. Gordon coming back late. The track conditions had something to do on a restart, but Stewart held off Jeff Gordon.
of love. Let me tell you, people, that I'm